Some serious shit.
It is the future, the year 2015. Okay, it's not as cool as we were promised, but it's not that different really. Instead of Jaws 19, we get Terminator Jenny CCs. It's the same thing really. We need to make a future for ourselves. A future where film lovers make film podcasts about why they love film. Where we stay positive no matter what the next batshit crazy Fantastic Four reboot rumor is. Come on guys, Star Wars and Mad Max are coming back, Brad Bird's got another movie out, Pixar have two. Stick with us folks, and you'll always see the bright side of movies. Don't mind the title, it's just ironic. Welcome to Movie Moan 2015! Everybody, and welcome to another edition of Movie Moan 2015. We are nearly there, folks. We are just one show away, that show being this one that you're listening to or watching right now, from the show that you always watch, that you always love, the big game of the year, fuck the Super Bowl, the Movie Moan 2015 summer box office prediction power 3 hours is gonna be up. In 2 weeks' time, it's going to be our next episode after this one, and we are so fucking excited. Joining me for that, as well as this, is my partner in crime, Mr. Jamie Williams. Game on!
Hello, sir. How are you?
I'm good. You know, I was going through that list, Jamie, and we've soft emails about this, but we don't really think of it right now. Maybe it's just because there's one or two movies that are eclipsed and everything else, but this summer's pretty fucking packed. We've had to lose a couple of titles that I actually would have liked to have discussed.
Yeah, and there's a few of them that are not on the list that are going to end up making an impact. And you kids out there in movie land are going to laugh, but Warner Brothers Max, watch out for it.
I'm sorry, that reference was far too obtuse for me. What are we referring to?
That's
here?
A new movie that's coming out in late June from Warner Brothers that is basically, for lack of a better term, it's American Dog. It's about a... Wait, you didn't see the trailer for this?
No. When you said Max, I immediately thought of that MTV Liquid Television show, The Max, the pink purple monster. So are they making that? I'm there. Where's the head?
Yeah, I was just thinking, yeah, in the head, there'll be like a head short film in front of it.
Oh, I'm there. Well, no, we had to... I mean, we might as well spoil it now, but we had to lose movies like Entourage and The Man from U.N.C.L.E.
Yeah. Oh my god, how are we gonna... What will happen without the Entourage movie prediction?
I bid 5 cents. I got 5 cents here. I don't know, maybe it'll do well opening weekend, I don't know. I know nothing about Entourage.
I never watched it.
we better move on then. Maybe this guy has. Joining us tonight, you love him. We always like to have him on. He is a bundle of joy and enthusiasm, and he is making it his personal mission to destroy any hope that is left for the Terminator franchise. Will you please welcome the man on the inside track, Mr. Matt Thompson?
Aw, thank you, Phil, for having me on in the episode that's just delaying the one that people actually want to listen to. I am honored to be here.
I didn't mean it like that. It's just the truth. And you can't handle it.
And for the people out there, I totally recommend Terminator Genisys. As long as you are drunk and not paying attention, I think you'll have a great time.
I've never heard of the first two.
Okay.
I can't wait to just make the internet retroactively decide that they really didn't hate Terminator 3. Because I always really liked it.
I don't think anyone ever did, you know.
What's that?
I don't think anyone ever hated it.
Oh, there was a lot of hate when it came out.
Well, that's just childish.
They still do. I mean, there are people who will say, oh my god, Salvation Man, that's way better than T3 was.
Those people exist?
They do. They do. I don't know if they can reproduce. I think they're sterile, but they exist.
I want a list of names on my desk. Execute Order 66. That's what I say for those people. Oh, man. Like I say, my position's quite childish. I would have accepted T3 as part of the series if 4 had worked. It didn't. And this one, this thing, well, I don't know what to call this thing. A good laugh. A good time.
I feel like T3's ending totally works as an ending. I mean, Judgment Day happens.
Which was the idea.
We have the last shot of the Terminator's eye going out. The war is here. We already know what happens in the war. The end. It's a good ending.
Hang on, though. Well, that's interesting, though, because basically, what is your position on the philosophy and the ideas of the series? Are we basically saying that we can change it, Kyle? Or are you saying Judgment Day is inevitable? Well, it's one or the other.
That depends. I mean, I tend to, I suppose, if I could choose, I side with the first movie. Because, and granted, the sequels ruin this, but I love how the first movie is a circle. There's no starting point. You know, sending the Terminator and Kyle back to change the war is what causes the war to happen. It goes around and around and around and around forever. I love that. Granted, the sequels ruin it, but I always side with the first movie, and so does T3. I mean, there's this John Brancato, who wrote the movie, has this awesome blog that I'm surprised is still up because it's like 6 years old, where he goes into the whole process of writing T3 and T4, and he flat out says he thinks T2 is bullshit and it ruins the point of the first one, and that they had to go back to it's inevitable, that everything is kind of preset and we're just building towards it.
That's interesting. Matt has typed in a question into the chat room here, which I think is a legitimate one, and I'd like to answer it on air. The reason you don't get to be on the box office show, Matt, is because you actually know how these things are going to turn out. We don't, so it's much better for us to live in our ignorance and blindly predict what these movies are going to do before we know. Green Lantern, Jamie here, predicted a $200 million domestic gross because
That's
he
right.
didn't know. And I predicted
I some stuff, motherfucker. Don't hold that against me.
I don't. I was just about to say I predicted 250 for Snow White and the Huntsman because I didn't know.
To be fair, I was also high on Snow White and the Huntsman. I thought that
everyone
great.
Was
being
everyone.
High is the only way to enjoy it, I believe. Oh yes, I got them all tonight. Oh, okay, folks, it's time for.
Do you want to do a Bob Hoskins joke now while you're there?
I want to move on with the show, you friggin' southern jackass. Sorry, that's been building up for a while. Okay, folks, if we ever get to it, it's time for Classic Movie Moan. Is that all right with you guys?
Whatever.
I would argue that this, what we're doing right now, is Classic Movie Moan.
Ain't that the truth? Keep it tight And there's not much going on movie news-wise so far, except for a couple of things. We've been, I feel, fairly conservative in our opinions towards Star Wars Cinematic Universe. I guess that's what we have to call it now. And or you don't have to call it that if you don't want to. But certainly, we've been conservative in the fact that we're not discussing it every single episode. This has been the first time, actually, since the rebooted show that I believe that we have. But obviously, in the light of all the news announcements that have come over the last couple of weeks, and the idea that their plan is not just air and rumour and hyperbole. No, Disney's really going to do this. They're really trying to bring out one of these movies every single year. And we need to now face the facts. Okay, this is what they're doing. Do we think it's a good idea? Do we think it's going to fall through? And what do we really want them to do? We've got Episode 7 coming out, and then we've got Rogue One, starring Felicity Jones, directed by Gareth Edwards, hitting December 16th, 2016. Apparently. And we've also got right after that, apparently, episode 8 coming out May 26, 2017. We'll see about that. And then apparently even JJ might come back for episode 9. A lot to digest. Matt wanted to be on this show. Matt is in, apparently. I believe, if I'm not misunderstanding him. Matt, are you excited?
You know, I am. I wasn't for a while. I was at a point where, you know, I was looking forward to Star Wars. Star Wars is my thing from when I was growing up. I was excited, but I wasn't overly excited. And then the trailer came out, and everyone was raving over the trailer. And even then, I was like, you know, it looks fine. It's interesting. I feel like people are being a little too much into it. But then, shockingly enough, I went to see John Wick at the Discount Theater in L.A., which, because they've upgraded to digital, they suddenly have current movie trailers, even though they're playing second-run films. So I'm sitting there in that theater, and for the first time, I see the Force Awakens trailer on the big screen. And for some reason, boom, I was in. I saw the Millennium Falcon flying, I heard the music, I saw the logo, and just my excitement level just jacked up. From that point on, I am so in.
Well, okay, but let me ask you this before Jamie comes in. You obviously, we want more Star Wars in our life right now. Do you want Star Wars in your life every year?
Do you mean, do I want 3 Star Wars films in my life in 17 months?
Basically, like, you have a Star Wars spin-off at Christmas, which sounds incredibly exciting. And then the idea of a Rian Johnson-directed Star Wars is certainly intriguing as well. But to wait just 5 months for it?
It's a to be continued. I need to see how different the spin-off is from the actual films. I mean, would you say, for instance, that doing Guardians of the Galaxy takes away from the Avengers in some way? They come out in a limited time period, but they don't feel like they're encroaching on each other. If Rogue One feels like its own kind of fun story, then no, it won't bother me. If Rogue One feels like we're just making another exact Star Wars movie with these side characters, then yeah, I'm probably going to feel pretty fatigued by the time Episode 8 comes out.
I think, I mean, obviously we're all making our assumptions based on that title, but I do feel like certainly when we're between Episode 7 and Rogue One, we are going to be dealing with a lot of, you know, retro spaceships, a lot of X-Wing pilots, a lot of breaking into Imperial installations and stealing shit, and then some close calls and escapes. A little bit of fun, a little bit of humour, keep it light. What Rian Johnson's doing, haven't got a frigging clue. But certainly those two movies are going to seem very, very similar. And then unless Johnson really, really shakes things up, if he's even allowed to do that, yeah, which is the real question.
Kathleen Kennedy's in charge, people.
It just feels different to me. I really, I understand exactly what you're saying, but the Marvel formula right now, which I personally respond to, is they say, okay, comic book movies can be anything. You can basically fit any kind of formula movie, genre movie, within that basic template. And they do, and that's how they sell them to us in the geek circles. They say, we've got political thrillers, we've got funky space operas with their classic soundtracks of 80s rock, and we've got whatever Avengers is, whatever you would call it, you know, the movie to end all movies. And we've got Doctor Strange, the, you know, the movie Jodorowsky never got to make. And they'll sell all these movies with a different label on. And I just don't know if you can do that specifically with Star Wars. Because,
well, the thing with the Marvel movies is stylistically the films are allowed to be a little bit different. Are they going to allow that with Star Wars, or are all of the spinoffs going to try to adhere to that sort of basic visual template that Lucas set up? You know, the irises, the no flashback rule generally. Are they going to hold to that, or are they going to be allowed to go off, do their own thing, and it's going to be really wacky?
I think, like most things, and like Marvel, it will need to go through the growing pains that Marvel went through. They will need to make an Iron Man 2. They will need to make a Thor the Dark World. They will need to make some suck before they can understand that, you know, people are going to respond to different things, and you need to make different things. That I think that's what's inevitable myself. Maybe that's being cynical.
Absolutely. And I'm very interested to see sort of, are they going to keep jumping around in the time period with these spinoffs? Because all indications are that Rogue One is set right around the original Star Wars. For instance, are we going to get, you know, a movie set between Episode 3 and 4? Are we going to get, like, an Obi-Wan movie at some point? How diverse are the stories going to be? It's so out there. We have so little information. It's hard to really decide. Although I am worried that when I grew up, and for the people listening, you know, I didn't grow up with the original Star Wars films. For me, it was the prequels, and fuck y'all, I like them. But that 3-year gap made every film feel special, something worth anticipating. And with the spinoff, with the episodes coming out so closely, I am worried, maybe in a silly fashion, but I am worried that the Star Wars name is suddenly going to be a lot less special.
It's going to be hypocritical of me to say, I mean, because I'll devour a Marvel movie if it comes out tomorrow. But I feel like, certainly in the case of this, if you're dealing with a specific series...
Not to interrupt you, though, but the difference is that Marvel, you can get different kind of flavors.
Yeah.
That makes any sense? Like, you know, you can get something like, even though I wasn't crazy about Guardians of the Galaxy, that's a different kind of movie. It doesn't have the same kind of tonality as the Iron Man movies. You know,
well, compare Winter Soldier to Guardians of the Galaxy.
Yeah.
I mean, they came out within 4 months of each other.
Right. Star Wars, it's still, you know, no matter what you say, like, it's a Star Wars movie. You know, you can't really make it that different.
Well, actually, I'm interested, are we for sure that Rogue One will even have Star Wars in the title? Because when they announced it, it's just been Rogue One.
Oh, no, they'll call it Star Wars. They have to.
Yeah, but we said the same thing when they announced The Dark Knight as a title. We were like, oh, no, it'll become Batman The Dark Knight, and it didn't.
I think what it won't have
is... That's a good point. I'll give you that.
It'll have Star Wars in the title. I don't think it will have the troops. I don't think it will have a crawl. I think it will be, for the first time, it will be... It have its own mood.
I almost think it won't.
It can't have a crawl. It can't.
No, I don't imagine it'll have that. I tend to think they won't do Star Wars in the same way that, you know, these Marvel films aren't suddenly Avengers Iron Man, Avengers Captain America. I feel like the Star Wars spinoffs are going to be their own thing. I really tend to feel like it's just going to be Rogue One. It's just going to be whatever the next thing is, so that they make the actual Star Wars episodes feel as big as the Avengers feels.
Oh, then they have to get clever with the sequeling titles. Rogue 1, 2. 1, 2, 3. 3, 2, 1.
I'm still not certain that Rogue One's even going to be out by next. I mean, that Episode 8 will be out by May of 2018.
Oh, it will. I mean... Remember,
I don't know, man. I mean, like, you know, remember Disney made the same kind of shit with crazy schedule with Narnia, if you remember. Like, everyone forgets this, but there was a period where, you know, that franchise was pretty huge. And Prince Caspian was supposed to come out Christmas 2007, and then the next one was going to come out summer 2009. And they basically said, we have no time. We cannot make
this. Disney readjusting itself. Remember, Disney wanted Episode 7 out in May of this year, and Abrams is the one that slowed it down. Disney recalibrating.
Yeah, but here's the thing that we knew logistically it was never going to be out in May 2015. We never needed – we always knew that.
But that was always Disney's intention, so they're trying to get it back on that schedule.
It was
especially
a fucking stupid idea, though.
If you have different directors, say it's Johnson for Episode 8, Abrams for Episode 9, I mean, you'd have to have the next movie shooting, you know, 3 or 4 months after the last episode came out. But you can hit that schedule. It's just a matter of kind of doing the marvel of it, of having an in-house factory that can work on the scripts, work on the stories, and have everything sorted out in time to make that schedule.
I said it before, I said it again, according to the current schedule, they have 2 space operas coming out in 1 month.
Guardians. In that instance, Guardians is moving, because Episode 8 is not missing the 40th anniversary of Star Wars. That's too big of a deal.
No. See, I disagree. So I could see Rogue One going to that, taking that date.
No way. They won't. 8's the big deal. No. Especially since Rogue One is supposed to start shooting in like 3 months.
I'm just telling you, I wouldn't be surprised.
No, not going to happen. I'm putting it down right here. I'm putting my finger down. Not happening.
Your finger down.
I don't need to know where your finger is, but that...
So usually you say you put your fist down.
My MacBook. I'm putting it down right now.
Okay.
I mean, getting back to the gap thing, I mean, I feel like if we're talking about specific installments of a franchise, the shortest gap that you should have that would work for me, just personally, would be what Potter did. A year and a half. That works. That allows anticipation.
That was long enough, yeah.
It's short enough that you get them quickly, but long enough that you feel excited for each one that comes.
It's perfect. And there was an accident that they fell into that, but it was a wonderful, perfect accident. Much like them being able to tie in some of the releases to the releases of the books. That, too, was genius. But
I remember when Order of the Phoenix and the last book came out, just the hype for Potter was so huge.
I've never seen anything like it in my life.
The closest thing I could equate it to was when I saw Star Wars Episode III, The Midnight Show.
Mm-hmm.
Just how insane it was everywhere. Just not just the theater or the bookstore, but everywhere around it was just enveloped by kind of fandom. It was really amazing.
But I'm glad you mentioned that, because I agree with you. I remember how excited I was for Episode 3. And I loved it too, first time it came out. I was just blown away by it. I absolutely adored it. And I remember the 2 weeks worth before it, where I became a complete slave to Lucasfilm consumer products. And I bought everything I really, really... Well, not the toys, I've grown out of that by then, but all the books, certainly, and all the spoilers, and I devoured absolutely everything I could. And I knew the whole thing before I went in, and it didn't really even matter so much. But that was because there'd been a gap. You know, it's not going to be the same for this one. I mean, I want to be desperately drooling in anticipation for Episode 8, but I don't feel like Disney's going to give me the chance.
That's basically it. It's going to feel ordinary, I think. And that's really sad, because Star Wars, whether you like the prequels or not, Star Wars never felt ordinary.
Again, I want to get back to a point that Matt brought up before, is like, you know, about the spin-offs and stuff. This is where we're coming into it, because I'm kind of like Matt. I suddenly got excited about the spin-offs just this week when I read about the news and heard that title, because everything I'd heard up until that point was about the most cliched bullshit you could possibly imagine. The Yoda, the true story, the Obi-Wan story, the Boba Fett story, all these kind of things which we just don't want to know. Stories which are going to be dictated by really, really tight parameters that have already been created in the continuity, when what we really want is them to take... there's two reasons why Star Wars has always worked to me. One of them is about the expansiveness of the universe, and one of them is about the family atmosphere. One of my favourite scenes in Star Wars is in Return of the Jedi, when the family of characters, Han, Luke, Leia, the droids, Chewie, they all climb into the rusty cockpit of the Imperial shuttle that they've stolen at the midway point. They're on the Rebel base, they're about to go into the second half of the picture. And all they're just getting into the cockpit, they're turning on all the switches in the cockpit, and, you know, Harrison's not really giving a shit, but hey-ho, there it is. But, you know, at that point you realise, yeah, when you really boil it down, that's what it's about. It's about this family that we've been through 3 movies and 6 hours with, well, 5 hours technically at that point. And really, if Star Wars is going to work this trilogy, it needs to have that same kind of quality. But the other idea, the other reason I love it, it's the scene in Empire Strikes Back on the bridge of the Star Destroyer where Darth Vader has all the bounty hunters assembled, and they're all different. They all look amazing. They're all different races. You wouldn't know their names. You never see them again. And all of them, because apparently they're terrible bounty hunters, you never see them again. They all just they just go off into their different adventures, and we never see them. And also, they even added a lovely little layer where, you know, the Imperial Admiral, what's his name? Piet says, "We don't need their scum." And that's the only time you ever hear about the conflict about that, you know, even Imperials hate fucking bounty hunters, you know. And it's never mentioned again, but it's just a little extra layer there. And you just wonder, what happened to all those guys?
I love what a sadistic shit-later Vader is in that movie, just killing people left and right.
He's the world's worst boss.
I'm suddenly thinking of the greatest Episode 7 ending ever, where everyone sort of expects at some point Harrison Ford will die because he's Harrison Ford and he doesn't give a shit about Star Wars. Maybe everyone's happy. And then at the end of the movie, a bounty hunter grabs Han Solo again, and it's just a dude who is really, really slow from when Darth Vader gave them the mission in Empire Strikes Back.
that one with the rat.
That reptile.
No. The other one, the guy, that just the portly dude.
The fat guy. Yeah.
Yeah, with the bandages on his head.
Actually, that was Porkins. Actually, what happened was, he really didn't die when he got shot down.
He became Dark Man.
Dark Porkins. I want to see that movie now.
But anyway, getting back to my long-winded point, if I just may very, very quickly, it's when I hear the idea that a movie could possibly be about the Death Star plans actually getting stolen, and you really think about it, and you think, that's cool, because really, what do we know about the Death Star plans? All we know is that they got transmitted to Leia's ship. That's it. We don't know who stole them. We don't know who sent them. And we don't know what happened to them. We know that. We know that. But that's...
Don't make it Han Solo.
Exactly. Well, that they...
I hate that. Like, that's a little too much. Like, oh, guess what? Han Solo was part of the group. In fact, I'd say don't even make it Boba Fett. But, like, that's... You kind of just... I guess you have to.
No, you don't. You don't. I think...
Apparently you have to, Phil. It's not my call.
Look, I mean, I'm fully for Boba Fett being in a Star Wars spinoff, but let's go an interesting route with it. How does he feel being a clone in a universe of clones? What is his personality like? Is he sad? Does he have trouble finding love? Let's make that Boba Fett movie.
Boba Fett.
That's exactly it. Let's see how fanboys react to Boba Fett in love. But she can't take him seriously because every other clone she knows is a dick.
I was trying to think of something to counteract that, but I got nothing.
Phil, if you can give me the recording of this, I'm just going to write it down so I can go pitch it to Disney tomorrow. So
that's fine. Go for it. But on a serious note, guys, I mean, do you think...
He is being serious.
I know. That's the sad thing. This business is crazy.
That's a good gig, dude. Are you kidding me? The pay? Oh, my God.
I know.
Phil, what was your point?
I was going to just say, do we think that is what Rogue One is? The Death Star heist?
Death Star, yeah.
I think so.
Are we on board?
Yeah, it could be fun. You know what? Everyone hated Godzilla, but I really dug Godzilla, so I'm in with Gareth Edwards.
I'm for that one. I mean, yeah, sure, why not?
It's really weird that the guy who wrote and directed American Pie is writing a Star Wars movie, but whatever. He also wrote.
Again, my issue is that it's the timing. It's just we're getting too much, man. There has to be cooling off periods, and you know, a movie a year, it can't work. It will back.
But again. How much of that is the actual movies, just to play devil's advocate, and how much is it our expectations of old Star Wars? Like we said, this could become a Marvel thing where all the spinoffs become their own original, distinct entities, and then would we be complaining that it's too much? But are we saying it's too much just because we're used to Star Wars coming at certain intervals?
There has to be cooling off for anything, though. Even after the original trilogy ended, there was a point where people kind of had to get away from it for a while.
Are people tired of Marvel?
Not yet. Give it time.
Give it time, but we're coming up on a decade now and people aren't tired of it yet.
That's a fair point.
I don't know if I trust my instincts because I very much agree where it feels like too much Star Wars. Not, you know, I keep saying the word ordinary, but another part of me is saying, yeah, but if I was a kid now, this would be what I'd be used to with Marvel and the films would be just as special as they'd ever be. So
when we boil it down, that's all that matters, really.
As a long-winded point goes, you know, we'll see.
It's true. When we really boil it down, I mean, we said it at the time the prequels came out, we said it during the cooling off period after the prequels, and it still holds true now. It's for children. I'm still a kid myself at heart, and that's fine. But it is for children, and it's for the fine investors in Disney consumer products. It's for those two audiences and those two audiences alone. And look, if they're great movies, we'll see as many of them as we want. But it's absolutely fine. But I just hope that, yeah, that's what continues. I mean, I'm absolutely... Do you know what, though? I've just had a moment of self-realization. Maybe that's making me a little bit of a hypocrite. You know how I've been saying for the last couple of weeks how, you know, the problem that Prometheus had was it was giving us answers to questions that we thought we wanted to know the answers to, but we really didn't. The space jockey has no actual impact on Alien, but it's there. It's a little piece of the mythology that suggests so much more, and we want to know the answers. Well, Star Wars and these spin-offs, they're in the exact same position, you know. Do we really want to know about the Death Star plans and the Bothan spies and the bounty hunters?
I think the Death Star plan idea is really cool. But yeah, I don't want every little thing explained. I don't want to see the movie about, you know, Yoda growing up and going to high school and it being sort of like a Fast Times at Richmond High type deal.
Oh, the last American Yoda... Virgin.
Yeah.
Here's kind of a distinction.
Boy, you keep saying that, Phil. When you see that movie, you are going to be like, Jamie, what the fuck do you make me watch?
Jamie, I think you're right. Here's the distinction in my head. I don't want to see about Yoda growing up his formative years. I would be totally cool with a movie with Yoda in it that actually had a good point and purpose.
I agree. That's my, yeah.
How diverse do you think they could get? Do you think we could see like an R-rated Star Wars film? And I only say that because I was shocked when I saw that Daredevil on Netflix is rated TVMA.
Yeah.
When it's still in the Marvel universe.
If we get an R-rated Marvel MCU movie, maybe we can have that conversation, but no, if this...
I'm not even saying I want an R-rated Star Wars film.
No,
I'm
of course.
If they would...
Ratings don't mean shit anymore.
Making an R isn't going to suddenly make it better. Like, oh man, it's so cool. That's what always needed was...
So gritty, guys.
Yeah, no, all we needed was to hear, like, you know, hear Leia say cocksucker. You know, no.
Actually, though, speaking of ratings, I remember it was a big deal that Episode 3 was PG-13. I remember people being shocked, like, how could you make it PG-13? And I'm like, really, guys? Like really?
That's right, yeah.
He kills children.
Well, he kills children, but
he kills younglings. He doesn't kill children, Phil. They literally had to say that.
Oh, is that why they say it? I didn't think about that.
Younglings in Episode 2.
Well, no, in the Episode 3, they're like, he killed younglings.
But they also
and they were so delicious.
I like that badass Darth Vader was given the most difficult mission of all. While the stormtroopers went after the Jedi, Darth Vader killed children. Because, you know...
I know, if I was a stormtrooper, I'd be pissed off. Like, we're doing the real work, and your ass is just killing little kids. Like, we're tired, man. We've been fighting in this war the whole goddamn time.
Maybe
oh,
that's
but he's a special protege.
It's just Anakin in that room with the kids. Let's go Saul with it.
I tell you, you know what? Okay, I'll give a spinoff I want to see, and I'm not even kidding. Well, I'm half kidding. There's those two guys in Star Wars, and I don't call it A New Hope, by the way, kids. It's called Star Wars. Where, remember, Obi-Wan is waiting for them to walk by, and they're just standing there bullshitting? Like, I want to see a movie about, I'm not saying those two characters, but a movie about the life of a average Joe stormtrooper. Like, what's
well,
it like?
We're thinking that a little bit in 7 with Finn.
Yeah, I guess. But that's like that's the modified hero. Yeah, but he's going on the hero journey, though. And I mean, hey, I like this kind of
an actual 9-to-5 stormtrooper?
I'm not saying a 9-to-5, but just like, what's it like
that
to be a stormtrooper on a
little
daily
bit of
basis?
Weight, have to ask his boss for new armor.
What's that fan film Troops you could watch?
I don't really want fan films.
No, Troops is funny. Troops is good.
Troops was the fan film. Yeah. It was like the first.
Yeah, it's just, Jamie, it's really funny. It's just like Owen and Brew having an argument with stormtroopers there acting as cops. It's really clever.
Oh, I've seen that, actually.
I want to say one final thing. I remember what the point was now. I don't think there's been any uproar whatsoever about it, but maybe a slight twinge of sadness. For example, if you're familiar with the Timothy Zahn books that came out in the 90s, which was, you know, its function was to be the third trilogy, the
Jason
trilogy that
Jamie.
Not again made. That's right. That too. But also characters that, you know, were popular for people who read them, like Mara Jade, the apprentice Jedi that Luke undertook, and Grand Admiral Thrawn, the alien who ran what was left of the Intergalactic Empire. And I do believe, and it will be a really, really crass way to appease fans and appeal to them, but I believe, even though they're obviously not taking any inspiration from the stories, those characters will be brought into the films.
Oh, I could see nods, definitely. Yeah, I mean...
Oh, not nods. They will be in them. At some point, they will throw them in. They'll be different.
They change in the books, too. Look, I'm not proud of this, people, but I remember... Like, I read the entire New Jedi Order as a kid, I remember. But even in the books, I mean, no one was consistent. The books lost me. There was a character, for the people who haven't read them, and for those who haven't, good on you, named Vergeer, who is just this really sort of interesting person whose take on the Force was not good or evil, was very different and quite a bit more complex than we had perceived in the films. And then apparently the books just turned into a Sith Lord. So it's just like...
The only ones I ever read... Wait, which one did you say? Which one did you read?
The New Jedi Order, which was like 20 books.
Okay, I read the... I never knew the title, but I'm just looking up now. It's called the
Jedi Academy, aren't you?
No, Jedi Prince, which started with the glove of Darth Vader. You remember that?
Oh, yeah, God, wasn't that a kids series? Like a really young...
That was a kids series, yeah. That was the only one I read. It was a bunch of those I read.
Shadows of the Empire.
That?
We all remember
yes,
that one.
Yes,
oh, my God. That game, and yeah, the it even had a soundtrack released by
it was. It was such a fascinating concept. They basically did everything they would for a movie, but the movie didn't exist.
It was like in a sense, it was the most commercialized thing ever because it was a big just marketing push for a product. But at the same time, it was so much fun to read the book and play the game.
And the timing was perfect at the time. Yeah. It was like, was it 96, I think? It did, by Joel McNeely.
Yeah. I remember also the Super Star Wars games. That was a great little...
Oh, man, those were good.
Rogue Squadron was my shit.
Rogue Squadron, yeah.
That's what I wanted to do. I remember. Yeah, I was like, oh, man, I love... I never had the one on the N64, but I had the ones on the GameCube.
I'm about to say, my ex-girlfriend sells my N64, so you can't get it.
No, I'm going to have to get a new one, aren't I? But that's another thing, and I tweeted this too, but look, you can do what you want with the films, but... For you not to be, and maybe you are, I don't know, but for you to be just throwing Star Wars away as a game license is really, really sad to see.
I think they're working on it. I mean, it's just
like they better fucking be. But
they need Battlefront at the very least.
Better be. Okay.
They fucking better be. They better be bringing Rogue Squadron back. They better be fucking doing. I just want to feel like a. You know, a rebel pilot. I want to feel like I take on the whole empire myself. I want to.
I think Rogue Squadron, wasn't it published by Nintendo? They might have some kind of rights to it.
So, moving on, and we won't spend too much time on this, but we're doing it as a personal request for me. I think Matt and Jamie are just indulging me on this particular point, but you know, fuck it, I co-host the show, so sometimes I get to talk about what I want.
You are the brains, I am the beauty of the show, so...
Yeah, that's nice of you to say, I think. But here's the thing, folks. Me and Jamie, one of our long-standing rivalries, of course...
We'll be in the home. I think the best quote was, we'll be in the home.
I never liked it! Sherlock Holmes, Weaver, nurse! You know. All right, break it up, you two. So I feel that we've always had a difference of opinion over Avatar. I still, to this day, watch the film and enjoy the film. And actually, last weekend, I hadn't seen it in a while, and I did the geekiest thing you could possibly imagine. I had some time on my hands, and I was really, really curious myself to see, because I've seen every cut of the film that's available, and I was really, really curious to see how it would play in its longest possible version. Now, the longest version available to you on the special edition Blu-ray is 178 minutes, but there's also a ton of deleted scenes, most of them in previs, most of them in, and some of them just footage of the actors in their mocap suits on the stage as well. A lot of it very, very, very rough. But there's some really interesting scenes in there, I thought, that answered a couple of questions, like what the fuck happened to all the other Avatar drivers who seem to be curiously absent from the climax. Well, the deleted scenes answered those questions. So I thought, I wonder how all this plays. And I did the geekiest thing imaginable. I edited all of them back into the film, and I ended up creating a version of Avatar that was 221 minutes long, and I watched it without a break, no intermission, and I really enjoyed it.
For the people listening, don't worry, we're getting Phil help.
Yes, I've only got a sore bottom from sitting there.
This is actually an episode of Intervention, not Movie Bones.
Well, I just did it because out of curiosity. Heck, you know, I'm sure there are some people out there who would gladly watch a 5-hour version of Apocalypse Now, you know, and I'm sure there are other examples we could. I'm sure there are people who would gladly edit the Godfather trilogy into one movie if they have. So this is just another example of that, and I was just curious, and I enjoyed it very much, and it just made me think about, you know, these damn sequels again, and what exactly we're going to be getting. And I tried to think about it on the positive scale, because when they announced just a second one by itself, Jamie will back me up, my reaction was, oh... Because Cameron's a filmmaker whose days ahead are far shorter than the ones behind him. I would rather see him... And it takes him so long to make his movies. I'd rather see him do something different. You know, don't put words in my mouth. I'll give you a chance to speak in a minute, you sort of a
bitch. No, I'm just saying it's like it took a while to make Avatar. Like, he shot, like, what, in 06? And it took so long to render all those effects.
Took him 4 years, all in all, to make it. It's true. And he's going to be made... First, it was one sequel, then it was two, and then it was three, and it gets a little bit crazy. And so there was a little... That was a little bit unfortunate for me, but I'm thinking about the positives. And certainly, as far as the second one is concerned, I feel that there's an immediate visual hook, a visual in for the audience, which is that it's going to take place in an underwater environment. You know how much I've been harping on about this Submariner movie I want to get made? Partly because I feel like it's something we haven't seen before. You know, a real dramatic, epic live-action movie with characters that live and breathe underwater. I assume that's what Avatar 2 is going to consist of, largely. And it is going to look like something we haven't seen before. We can be assured of that. And people love being taken to that kind of environment. So 2's got a hook. 3 and 4 haven't got a fucking clue. But I would like to think that they are going to have different stories. It's very hard to visualize them right now because you imagine that if this story is going to move on, it's going to have to take place in different planets, different galaxies. But how the fuck do these characters get around? They don't teleport. They don't have spaceships. How do they go? And, you know, what's the plot going to be? The humans come back for more? I don't know. I don't see it. So it's hard to visualize. But I just wanted to throw it out there and say that I'm still hopeful, I'm still optimistic, and will be till they come out, and, you know, we'll see what happens. And it's going to be really interesting more than anything, of course, just to see how the public reacts, because it was... The reaction to Avatar was one of the most curious things I've ever seen. It was obviously a phenomenal box office hit, but it was not a pop culture phenomenon. They're two different things. You know, pop culture phenomenon, to me anyway, is something that sticks with you, where the lines of dialogue and the scenes enter water cooler conversations at work and, you know, things like that, and people dress up as the characters year after year after year. It's not a Dark Knight kind of movie, you know. It didn't happen with Avatar. It was just a movie that people certainly saw a lot, but that it didn't really stick, and it hasn't really stuck with us since. So it's going to be fascinating to me to see how we react. I mean, whether when we finally get a teaser poster or a trailer for Avatar 2, is it a nostalgia we'll be feeling? Or we'll be just like, oh, I remember when that came out. Or, you know, it fucked, it always fucked. And that's my geek voice. And it's going to be fascinating. So more than anything, it's the fact that the competition now with just the series we've been talking about makes it... are just a whole different playing field. So I'm totally game for at least Avatar 2, just because I'm just going to be so interested to see the impact that it has on us and the movie nerd geek culture, and just as a visual experience. The other two, haven't got a clue, but I've got every hope in it myself. But hey, that's just me. I'm always going to be a champion for Avatar 2. Just so you know, I'm putting that out there. That is going to be my position.
But you're being reasonable. You're just saying Avatar 2 is where your optimism is.
Absolutely. That's all I can say.
Yeah,
he might change his mind again, you see. He might just say,
it's weird. I remember we were at another site running it, me, you, and Peter. Fox put out a press release putting a date on it, and they said Christmas 2014 and Christmas 2015 for 2 and 3. And maybe a month later, Cameron said, I didn't agree to that. They kind of put that out without my approval. Mm-hmm. And if we know anything about Fox, is that they listen to Cameron. Like, they kind of just let him do what he wants. Wisely, obviously. But yeah, the changes, they've been changing their plans several times since then on this movie. Now it's 3 sequels. And there was a pretty good article... I forgot what it. I think it was over at Forbes about the lack of impact of Avatar, and it made an impact in pop culture, but just not the film itself in terms of the 3D movement. That's its real impact. Mm. And I to this
Avatar
day,
is its legacy. That's why everyone saw the film, and I think people liked the film, but it was more about, hey, this is a cool experience, as opposed to this is a great movie.
I only slightly disagree with that, just because, like, the home video sales were phenomenal. Like, I think it was, like, the top grossing DVD of all time or something. Or maybe not number one, but it was
the top selling Blu-ray, I believe, for a while. It got beaten by Frozen. But, yeah. Okay. But again, you can also go down. If you have a, you know, a brand new high def television and you got a Blu-ray player, you probably want Avatar to show off to your friends.
If you go into the store, it's demoing Avatar, or was, for a while.
Avatar tells a complete story, and I kind of just wish Cameron would move on to something else.
And I didn't like, I hate the movie, but I really liked the ending, because I was like, alright, that's how you end it. Like, that's a really good ending.
You know when the last shot is happening that it's the last shot of the movie. Just, it's perfect.
So, yeah, I agree. I completely agree with that. And so it's like, well, where do you go from there? You don't need to. It's one of those things where, as much as the movie, we're not going to review the movie here, obviously. So I'm not even going to say anything derogatory towards it. But you know, Cameron at least treated. I like endings like that, where like it treats you, the audience, with respect and intelligence, so that they fill in the rest of the blanks for themselves. Like,
well,
they know.
It's rare at this point that we get an ending that's actually an ending.
Yeah.
And not just, here's great one point. Piece of a bigger puzzle.
Yeah, there's not like little sequel setups. There aren't, and you know, if Cameron claims there are, then with all due respect, he's lying. There's no, I mean, that is, that's so self-contained.
I think the only thing that would ever worried me about it was that, you know, when he starts talking about characters that have clearly died that are coming back, that's when the warning bell's going to come off. I don't want to see Sigourney Weaver as a talking tree.
Or Stephen Lang coming back. I
mean, or clones of Stephen Lang or stuff.
Yeah, but like, I remember who was at El Maive over at Latino Review was like, hey, they're getting Schwarzenegger in the movie. And I'm like, I could buy that.
Well, I always joke to my friends that if you did a sequel to Avatar, or like what the trailer is, you show the people of Pandora, you pan up to like a new fleet of humans coming in, and the leader of the humans is just Arnold Schwarzenegger with a giant cigar in his mouth. Cut to black, everyone will see that movie.
Maybe.
Yeah, I'm kind of quiet. Like, I don't know, would they?
Well, let me be clear. When I joked that, this was after Avatar came out, not it was before Arnold actually started making movies.
Before
again.
Arnold became poison, that's right, yeah. I'm about to say, now, if the movie was about Arnold having affairs with a Navi women, then I'd say I'd
watch
that.
Nobody cares about that, Jay. I swear to God, Arnold's drop in popularity has nothing to do with that. I know you latch on.
You're wrong. I'm just saying, but that's okay. I still love him.
I hear why people don't like him. It's not that.
I'm just telling you.
I'm telling you, you're wrong.
Moving
on.
I'm just telling you.
I assume part of what Cameron is going to be doing in the next couple, and that's why it's taken him like a whole trilogy to tell this story, is he's really going to basically push the environmentalist thing to the fullest and say that it's not that humans want to get the resources from Pandora, it's that at this point we're so fucked that we need to leave. It's fucking Titan AE is the next one. They have to leave Earth.
Well, I mean, that's a natural way to get there. It makes sense with the story he told in Avatar. Like, if Pandora is the only place that they can really go, then it makes sense. Mm. And then they kill all the humans at the end.
But like I say, the only thing I can't get my head around is just, you know, why, how it's going to take place on other planets. That's the bit I can't wrap my head around. There's no way, surely, that the Na'vi can go from one. I know
it'll be an analogy of Native Americans, like getting thrown off their land by the Pilgrims. Cameron is one of the best. How should I put this? He knows what audiences want.
I would go so far as to say Cameron is maybe the best populist director at this point.
Okay, the best, and I wouldn't argue with that actually. But my thing, even more so than Spielberg, I'd say him, Cameron and Chris Nolan know exactly what audiences want.
Oh, Cameron more so than Nolan. I love Nolan. Cameron gets more audiences than Nolan does.
I agree. I'm saying, my point being is, I wonder if maybe he shot, like, he had a take where they did that.
And timing, too. Timing is always a big factor, but he always knows when to bring these movies out. Whether it's by design or not, the timing is always right when he brings out one of his movies. That's why I'm so interested about this one. Because
I think Titanic was a happy accident. I think with Avatar, it was calculated. Although originally, and people forget this, it was supposed to open Memorial Day 2009.
Yes.
Yeah, and Titanic was supposed to be a summer movie, too.
Yeah, that was a happy accident. I think that was literally like, shit, we can't finish it. Just put it during Christmas.
Oh, Avatar was much the same way. I've heard things about Avatar's production, dude. Avatar was a mess production-wise for a while. They pulled it together. It's really impressive.
Which Matt will tell us off air. Sorry, kids.
Indeed. I mean, but I'm not talking about though that the difference between a couple of months and the release date. I'm talking about obviously just the year, the time, the landscape in movie culture when it came out. When Titanic came out, you know, we hadn't seen epics for a long time. I remember when people were balking at the running time. It's like we hadn't actually had a movie, a populist movie. Obviously, we had Scorsese pictures like Casino and stuff, but not a movie of that length that it was supposed to appeal to a broad audience.
And do you kids remember what the most anticipated movie going to that Christmas was?
Is it Tomorrow Never Dies or something?
Scream 2.
Oh.
That was all the hype.
I won a trivia contest once with that question.
Why didn't you remember it now?
Yeah, exactly.
Well, I thought he was talking about 2009. I didn't realize 97. I'm really interested to see what happens if we actually get a Star Wars movie and an Avatar movie in the same month. Because
I just can't see it. I cannot see it.
Oh, we won't get it by next year. You kidding me?
But I almost feel like maybe Fox will do it as kind of like a fuck you to Disney because Star Wars used to be theirs. But I think Star Wars would win. I think people liked Avatar, but I don't think they loved it. And I think the sequel is going to have a big drop no matter how good it is.
I feel like
Avatar would be like $400 million.
I could see Star Wars going up against an Avatar 3 or 4. Once you know what the voting's going to go like from the public. But you can't. You cannot, no matter how much predicting and analyzing you do, you cannot say what Avatar 2 is going to do. You can't do that.
I absolutely think if it comes down to a pissing contest, which is possible, Disney will think Star Wars can hold off Avatar, even Avatar 2. I mean, studios do this sometimes. I remember...
It won't be a special because we'll have seen two fucking movies sequentially.
But, I mean, it's very possible. I remember in 2009, it was four movies, but Final Destination 4... and Halloween 2 were put on the same date. And Warner Brothers and the Weinsteins just were in such a fuck you, we have the bigger dog thing. They actually came out the same day. It can't happen if the studios are, you know, testosterone charged enough to do it.
Like those two Lombardo movies.
I remember the other time it happened was, this is going back years, was Ghostbusters and Gremlins came out the same day.
Oh yeah, they did, didn't they?
Both mega hits, both zeitgeist films, both big in the pop culture, but Ghostbusters was always the bigger movie.
Thing I'm so most curious about above all is the scores. Like it's obviously a fact now. It was always going to be that they're bringing in different composers for this. And I mean, man, that is. I hope someone can pull a John Ottman on the Star Wars score and actually bring something different and not be afraid. But you don't know.
Rogue One is what? Alexandre Desplat?
Alexandre Desplat, which is interesting.
But he did Deathly Hallows 1 and 2, and he did great jobs with those.
Oh, he did.
Bernie Williams themes.
I don't think he used the Harry Potter theme once, as far as I can remember.
In Hallows 2, he uses the Potter theme a lot, actually.
Fair enough.
Yeah, the first one is more its original score, but he even incorporated stuff from like Nicholas Hooper from Order of the Phoenix and Half-Blood Prince. Desplat's very good at taking someone else's music and kind of using it in his own way.
I guess that's why he's got the job then.
Yeah, that should be a very interesting score. The question is, I have to believe Episode 7 is John Williams' last Star Wars movie. So who's going to score Episode 8?
Giacchino. Everyone knows this.
Ryan Johnson?
Yeah. Even so.
I think Giacchino should have done Episode 7, frankly. I'm sorry, with all due respect to Mr. Williams.
We need one last Williams. We need Williams to
We don't. I mean, the whole point is to bring in fresh blood to carry this on.
Episode 7 is a nostalgia trip. You need the nostalgia. The whole point of this
movie... You can do it with Giacchino. Okay.
Also, as much as I like Giacchino, I don't know. I like his music, but I don't think he's... I do not think he's of the caliber of Williams or Desplat.
I think he could get there. I mean, I think that his Star Trek score is, you know,
his score is really, really fun, but it's not really special. And then he basically just reused it again in Into Darkness.
Well, I mean, I'm not talking about Into Darkness' score. I'm talking about Star Trek's score.
But yeah, but I'm saying you want him to score multiple films. Well, his Into Darkness score is pretty much exactly his Star Trek score.
I've heard the Into Darkness score.
Is a retread of the first one.
He uses the exact same cues in the exact same places.
In the movie, but I tell you, there is a great score there waiting to get out. You just don't hear it in the film.
He would be writing it for the same director as Into Darkness if he does not.
I get that, true. But, I mean, let's just be honest here. I mean... I hate to say it, but I'm going to back Jamie up on this. It is possible, there's no way to prove it, but it is possible that Giacchino might do a better job than Williams. I don't remember his Kingdom of the Crystal score being that great.
You're right, but every single John Williams Star Wars score has been great, so I have to assume his next one would be too.
I don't disagree
and
with
even
that.
Indiana That's Jones, like his Temple of Doom score wasn't great. I mean, it's fine.
Are you serious?
I'm serious. It's fine. It's a good score, but it's not.
It's the best score. It's the best one of the lot.
Really?
I can't remember.
Really? I don't know if I agree with that one.
I can't think of a single thing from it right now. If you ask me to think of a beat, I can't think of a single score moment.
I can sum that entire score. Oh my god!
Remember a single line from it at this moment.
We now take you live to Phil G recreating the moment.
This is why you are on our next week's show. Oh my god!
I don't like the idea. Say what you will about like Blomkamp's Aliens sequel, whatever they're going to call it. But like, so help me God, if they say, oh, and James Horner's going to score it, I'm like, no. No.
Like, it wouldn't matter. All of Horner's stuff sounds the same anyway. You could just retrack stuff from Aliens.
Whoa, I'm not going to say that.
His Aliens score is great. Again, you just don't hear it in the film.
As as introduced in the film, Horner's Star Trek II, Aliens, and Avatar scores are very similar to each other.
Similar motifs.
That's Horner's shit. I mean, I'm not... They work in the moment. Even Titanic. I mean, Titanic, huge chunks of it sound like Aliens. It's just what he does.
Let's move on to this point for our segment of the show, which, you know, I'd like to call it something else, but let's be honest, it's the Daredevil show at this point. It's nothing else. But we ain't going to talk about that this week. This week, we're going to talk about some different things. We're finally going to friggin' turn our attentions to X-Men, and while we're just bloody sick of it at this point. And we're actually going to talk about that thing I can't shut up about, that man in underpants with winged feet known as Submariner. So join me, I'm Mr. Spencer Perry, for Marveling at the Future. Hello everybody, and welcome to Marvelling at the Future, the podcast dedicated to... Oh, who are we kidding? It's the Daredevil podcast. I've lived with this charade long enough.
Here comes Marvelling at the Future.
Exactly, I mean, I've tried to talk about other things, but it's gonna be all about Daredevil. It's not really, but I mean, I will say that... we did our last show. I think it went rather well. I think you guys enjoyed it too. I still think I've even converted a few people into believing in the power of this character and how well he can be translated to television. But, of course, we did that whole piece on how the show's going to play out, how we dream it will. And then right after we've done it, then they release the next trailer. And what...
Announcements and motion posters.
That's true as well, yeah, because Gladiator's gonna be in it, and yeah. that what a trailer that was. So also joining me tonight is the guy who also can't contain his enthusiasm for that show for all sorts of reasons. I am insanely jealous of him right now. We might not talk about that, I'm not quite sure, but it is superherohype.com's Mr. Spencer Perry. Hello, sir.
Hello, everyone.
Spencer regularly writes Spencer's Soapbox. He's been writing it for 10 straight weeks. Every single week without fail, we get a new Spencer Soapbox. But what is on the Soapbox this week, Spencer?
Today's Soapbox is... Stop calling superhero movies realistic.
That's the problem I had with Amazing Spider-Man 1. It was trying to be real.
And I addressed that in the article. It's in the first paragraph. Is that was the whole reason that Sony rebooted Spider-Man was they wanted to do the dark, gritty, grounded, realistic Spider-Man. And then what did they do? They made the Lizard the villain in the first movie. And then in the second movie, not only did they do Electro and the Green Goblin, but they put Paul Giamatti in Rhino armor.
Then again, on an ironic level, we are also championing this Daredevil show, aren't we? And if any show is making the claim that this could all be happening right now in some seedy part of New York...
It's definitely playing the grounded, gritty, realistic card. And I don't hold that against these movies. Like, when Man of Steel was being made, they were calling it the grounded, realistic Superman, which is just ridiculous. But I still like Man of Steel. Like, I don't hold it against these things because they use that. I just want filmmakers and studio heads to stop using that as the selling point to fans. Like, that's not what we want to hear when you start talking up these projects that are coming up, especially when you've only made one movie. And I'm specifically referring to the Warner Brothers CEO who said that their movies are steeped in realism and all this other stuff. And it's like, it's easy to call your movies one thing when you haven't even made half of them.
No, absolutely. I mean, I feel that, what's the best way to say this? I remember that... I'm bringing it back to Daredevil, I know, but here's the thing. The first time I ever really even heard about Daredevil but got excited about Daredevil was actually back when, it was probably 2001, something like that, Harry Knowles on Ain't It Cool News actually got his hands on the screenplay for Daredevil, written by Mark Steven Johnson. And I don't know why I clicked on it. I don't know why I was particularly interested, but it was a gushing review. And he actually mentioned something that was on the first page of that script, which is to this day stuck with me. And I almost wish they'd put it in the movie as a little title card. And the quote was this. This is how the screenplay opens. Forget what you know about superheroes, because this is the real world. And in the real world, there is no such thing as mutant healing factors or adamantium skeletons to keep a man alive. In the real world, there's just a guy in a mask, and he's bleeding to death. And I was in.
That's awesome.
Isn't it just? Let's move on, folks, because what we're going to talk about this week is slightly more fantastical. We're going to move away from the real world. We're going to take inspiration from Spencer's article, and we're going to talk about a couple of things, including a guy with wings for feet who just wears underpants and some a couple of other things.
You're talking about Jamie.
That's private. But first, we're going to talk about something that... I know I've wanted to do on this show since we started. I wanted to do it before then, actually. It's been on my mind for a long time, and I'm just going to scream this out, and hopefully I'm going to get some kind of response from you, the faithful listener. Just reboot X-Men already, please. I need to give full disclosure on this. I am perfectly happy, as far as a rights issue is concerned, with things the way that they are. I want X-Men to stay with Fox. I feel that if you bring them in to some kind of multiverse, that's the terminology of the day, isn't it? That's what we're all using. But I feel like if you bring them into a universe where other heroes exist, it just completely takes the edge off why the X-Men work as a cinematic concept. I cannot possibly buy into a world where humans, Homo sapiens even, are throwing broken bottles at damn muties, and at the same time Thor flies by and says, "Hey Thor, my wife loves you!" It doesn't work, you know. You can't accept one thing and absolutely hate on the other thing. If X-Men is gonna work, then it needs to be in its own universe, where the only superpowered people to create jealousy in the average Homo sapien are the mutants themselves, the X-Men. So I'm happy with things to say the way that they are. And the only other thing, though, is that it's done. This series is done. No one's going to listen to me until it actually does run itself into the ground. And I'm enjoying the movies that they're making right now, but I have been saying it from day one, that X-Men Days of Future Past, that is the last story. You cannot possibly get me to believe in the stakes of this universe anymore when you have done the ultimate wipe the slate clean story. We're done. I am not looking forward to X-Men Apocalypse in any way. Okay, I'm curious about Apocalypse himself, because I always thought he was a rather tricky character to translate on screen. So, and I've heard some things about how he's going to look, and apparently we're not going to be disappointed in that regard. It's going to be pretty faithful. It's just going to look weird to me, but, you know, I'm certainly interested to see how it goes. But I'm not loving it. Especially when I hear quotes like, "This time we're going to focus on Mystique and Magneto." Fuck off! I'm sick to death of Mystique. I can't believe I'm saying that. But at this point, that character is played out. At this point, the idea that Magneto has not been defeated or dispatched in any way is just downright parodic. He was shot in the neck in the last movie, if you don't forget. And at the end of it, as I made the big joke, he just immediately floats away into the ceiling like Poochie the dog. I have to go now. Whoop! And off he goes. It's just ridiculous. I do love X-Men Days of Future Past, but, you know, I had some issues with it. And I just don't see any future in this particular series that is getting me excited. What I am excited about is wiping the slate clean. because I do feel... And by the way, I know it sounds like, you know, a dirty way to reboot something very, very so very soon after you've done the initial series, and it's fraught with risk, and it's fraught with people turning up their noses at it. But I only say it uniquely in this circumstance because I really do believe that there is a completely separate vision of the X-Men that you can portray on screen, which is going to be spectacular, epic, and dare I say, if you do it right, could once again take the crown as the best series of comic book movies out on the marketplace. But before we go into that, of course, Spencer, do you feel the same amount of exhaustion and apathy as I do right now?
Of the four X-Men movies that are currently on the calendar, the one that I want to see is the new Wolverine movie. And that's not even because, like, I'm such a Wolverine fan. It's because I really like James Mangold and I really like Hugh Jackman. So it's not even like a fan of the character, a love for the character. It's just like I like the way those guys make movies, so I want to see another one.
It was a very cool movie, the last one.
Yeah.
It still holds up in my opinion. Yeah, Viper's shit, but I like the ending. I love the Silver Samurai robot, old man. I don't give a shit. I love
it too.
Why hasn't Hot Toys made that thing yet?
That is a great question.
Yeah. Nothing. It's bullshit. Anyway, well, here's what I'm saying, folks, is that obviously we're dealing with a series which, in a lot of ways, you look at X-Men 1, and that is a movie that is unique in that it couldn't be made today. You're talking about a movie whose every frame, you feel the budget. You feel the budget of $75 million, just choking it. $75 million. I think that's what Downey makes these days, just to do the movies, you know. So it's absolutely crazy to think about the circumstances in which that film was made. And you just wish, certainly I do myself, that, you know what, if you reboot it, next time we're going to get an X-Men Part 1. That is really something different. You know, it's not going to be, you know, a remake. It's not going to be repeating steps of its predecessor. It's not going to encounter those kind of problems that Amazing Spider-Man had, because Sam Raimi's Spider-Man was not a modestly budgeted film. I think it cost $140 back in 2002. That was a serious amount of dough. So that was a big budget spectacle, competing with a reboot, which was a big budget spectacle. But with the new, and I'm going to call it the Uncanny X-Men from now on, full title. Wouldn't that be nice? So I really feel like, certainly with an X-Men Part 1, if you do, heck, and I've no problems with even with you doing Magneto in the next one, in a rebooted story, but make it the definitive X-Men versus Magneto and the Brotherhood story. And I'm talking about something where you really do feel the stakes of what happens when these kind of powers, these kind of mutants collide and we're caught in the crossfire. I'm talking about the version where Magneto can literally fly out to the ocean in his magnetic bubble shield and hijack a nuclear submarine and its payload, drag it back to his island and threaten to throw the fucking missiles at the United Nations unless they bow to his demands and, you know, give, you know, equal treatment and tolerance to all mutants and all that kind of thing. And the X-Men having to, you know, we're getting into the whole X-Men arcade thing now. Go, X-Men! And, you know, they have to fight him and all that kind of stuff. Or if you want to go crazy, do you know what? I'm fine with the asteroid. I'm fine with Asteroid M. Because that's the thing. This is what I'm talking about. The movies sometimes make us forget it. But, you know, X-Men is not grounded, to get back to what Spencer was saying. It is one of the biggest fantasies and one of the most colourful and playful universes that Marvel has to offer. It's got the mutants, it's got the savage land, it's got the prehistoric times, it's got alien empires like the Shah. The Phoenix Saga is actually about an alien life form taking over Jean Grey. I actually loved what they did in X-Men The Last Stand and made it sort of a psychological split personality thing. I actually think that worked really well for the 20 minutes they spent on that plotline. But I really feel like there's a different way you can do it. So here's what I'm pitching, folks. I really think that what you need to do with the next couple of X-Men movies, reboot it, start it over again. Let's do things differently. First of all, as far as the main cast is concerned, we've got to do Cyclops right this time. Can I get an amen?
Amen.
We've got to get a leader here. People, I mean, I don't even realize it. I didn't realize it until I've talked to people, but people fucking love this character. Fans of the comics, I mean. They fucking love Cyclops. He's a hero.
There's a reason that Cyclops Was Right is a t-shirt that Marvel sells.
Really?
Yeah, yeah.
I shall buy one of those. Buy now. So let's have a real heroic Cyclops who's leading the fucking charge. Let's have a Storm who... Let's just have a Storm this time. Let's try that. You know? We can have... I know a lot of my conditioning goes back to the... You know, 90s animated series, but you know, let's have sexy Rogue and let's have ugly Wolverine. I'm sorry, I know it's a risk, I know it's going to take so much courage for the studio to go down this route, but you really have to. If you're going to replace Jackman, you don't get another Jackman. You can't. Yeah. You have to get a Jackie L. Haley. I know that's the obvious name to say, but when I say that, you know what I mean. I mean unconventional, not handsome, short, stumpy, ugly, and he earns our love and our respect. That's what you do. And it's not Wolverine and the X-Men movie. We're talking about a movie where they're all equal. And we have movies that are huge, epic length. You know, let's go Christopher Nolan for this. Let's do them as, you know, 2.5-hour IMAX spectacles. And every single one of the movies we're talking about, they're not, you know, episodic sagas in the same way that the X-Men movies were. You know, we love what Bryan Singer did, but they were episodes to me. They were installments. They weren't... Yeah. Wasn't a saga. You know, X2... It's not really about anything to me. It's about a lot of things, or some of which get completed and resolved in that movie, some of which he intended to go further with in his X-Men 3. And that's, you know, partly why we were kept left with our dicks hanging out in the wind when things went south on that. So with this one, you don't have the opportunity to let that happen. You have epic movies which take a specific element or a theme, and you make the definitive movie about that theme. The Uncanny X-Men Part 1. It's the definitive Magneto movie. It climaxes. It's all about the relationship between Xavier and Magneto. Their history, what they've both built, their ideologies, two co-opposing viewpoints that completely clash, and they have that fucking epic showdown at the end. It all comes down to them. And then movie 2... Then you bring in the humans. Then you have the definitive, you know, version of the human antagonist, the human conflict, and what humans are prepared to do to actually erase mutants, you know. And, you know, there's a lot of, you know, God love, man kills that, you know, you might end up repeating in that one. I haven't figured out exactly what to do in that regard. Maybe do the legacy virus, maybe do the AIDS thing. I know Jamie's very big on that. Maybe you can do that, that's fine. Then, Uncanny X-Men Part 3... Do the Phoenix Saga properly this time. Please. You can do it in one movie. It does not need to be a two-parter. It's just got to be a fucking epic movie. And it's not about issues. It's not about the tolerance thing. We'll have done that. This, at this point, is about... You know, it is kind of like, you know, Star Trek 3, The Search for Spock. It's about a bunch of characters, a very tight-knit group, a family... That are family to you as well, that you love, and they are getting put through the ringer. They've lost one of their own, and they will do anything they can to bring them back, even when they're faced with this impossible conundrum of the fact that their best friend and someone they love very dearly, Jean Grey, has been possessed by an alien life form who has done many, many terrible things, destroyed millions and millions of lives at this point, and is due to be exterminated by this alien empire, the Shah, which has been hunting. And it all comes down to, you know, fucking battle royale with a heart-pounding, traumatic climax, which doesn't have a happy ending. The cartoon did, I remember that bullshit, but the comic certainly did not. And... You know, if it stops right there, it stops right there. And, you know, the other movies we can figure out. You can make the definitive Vex Apocalypse movie. You can make the definitive Mr. Sinister movie. You can... I don't know if you want to do Days of Future Past again, personally. But if you do, you can. There's plenty of ways you can do it differently. You can fucking make Bishop the star this time. That'd be nice. And Kitty Pryde. Things like that. There's so many things you can do. But that's what you do. You make each one... definitive about a specific aspect of the X-Men universe, and If the movies are good, there's nothing better than a good X-Men movie to get us geeks talking. This time also, most importantly, you make the continuity tight. You don't throw in random characters with diamond skin because you think they'll look good and then realise later on, oh shit, we might actually need to use them properly for something and now you're in the shit. No, this time you learn from your mistakes and you make the continuity really, really tight. You only use characters when you need them. Every character is unique. Every character is colourful. Bring in the colourful costumes. You can do it. Not all of them, but some of them, you can make them work. A talented costume designer can make these costumes work. Because let's face it, if Marvel Studios had the rights to the X-Men, that's what they would be doing. They would find a way to make Cyclops' costume work. He will be wearing blue duds of some sort and a yellow belt. Fucking count on it. They pulled off Thor. They're not afraid to go large and go big. And judging from the audience reaction, they ain't afraid either. It's not a problem for them. It never was a problem for them. Okay, the Phantom was a problem for them. Purple just doesn't work. But apart from that, it's fine. As long as we believe in the characters, just do the uncanny X-Men. Please. What do you think?
You know, I like your plan, but I will say this, and this is my complaint with the films that they have now for the X-Men movies, is, and something that I would like to see them steer clear of moving forward, is that the movies are so big. Like, every single movie is about the end of the world, the end of the mutant race, the end of the humans. Genocide is on the table in every movie. And I think they need to really scale it back. Not necessarily make them, you know, like, dramatic movies that are all talking for, you know, an hour and a half, but they need to be a little bit, they just need to rein it in, make them a little smaller, because not every story arc in X-Men, the comic books, was about the world coming to an end, or about terrorist attacks, or about, you know, viruses wiping out all these people, or all of these things, but, you know, sometimes it does happen, and it's appropriate to do it every once in a while. But another thing, and I think it goes along with what you were saying, but it's something that they haven't done necessarily in the current films, is that the X-Men, they're not like a military operation. They're like a family. It's a school. It's people that, you know, they're friends, and they love each other, and they're not counter-terrorists, even though they fight Magneto, who is a terrorist. So, you know, doing the leather outfits, the coordinated leather outfits, and then, I get that the X-Jet is part of the canon of the comic books, and you kind of have to include it into the movies, but they're not soldiers. They're people that just happen to have powers. And I think that's something that really gets undercut in the movies, but I think that's something that could be hit upon in what you were talking about. One thing that I'd like to see, and it'll never happen because what he did with it was just, it's so genius, but it was so out there, was, and I don't remember if we talked about this actually on the show or if it was off air that we were talking about it, but I finished reading Grant Morrison's run on New X-Men a couple weeks ago, and this was early 2000s that he wrote it. It went from like 2001 to 2004, and the things that he did in the comic at that time are still being felt in the stories that they're currently publishing for Marvel, which is just bizarre that they wouldn't have evolved their own characters with stories to have gotten them past those points. But no, they're some of them are exactly the same as they were 13 years ago when Grant Morrison created some of the characters. That's just the nature of the comic book business, which is another episode entirely. Mm-hmm. So, but what he did was, like you were saying, he created a saga. Like, things happen in the first issue of his run of New X-Men that are felt in the final issue of New X-Men. Mm. And it's the way, I don't know if there's a way to break down his 40 issue run into like a 3-movie saga, but It tells a complete story, and it portrays the X-Men in how I think they should be portrayed, which is like a school, on the surface, you know, at night, sometimes the teachers leave because they have to go save a mutant who's being terrorized, or they have to stop a robot that's killing all these other mutants, or maybe an entire island of mutants is destroyed and they want to go investigate what happened, or sometimes aliens show up. So, and I, you know, I'm a big Morrison fan anyway, so I would love to see his work on the screen, but some of the characters he created are just so weird and out there that a studio would look at them on the page and go, can't fucking put this on a movie screen and expect people to pay money for it.
You just reminded me of something. The moment you said island, it triggered in my head, I know what I want to. Genosha. Genosha.
Yeah, yeah.
Do you know why? My in to Genosha is so weird compared to what other people might feel. But, you know, I was trying to think, even years ago, how they could have brought Genosha in and really made it work when we're talking about, you know, how is the real world going to react? And you know, let's just keep it real here. Prejudice still exists. I wish I could believe in Gene Roddenberry's vision of the future where we will one day conquer such things. But right now we're nowhere close. So that this latent racism still exists within us as a species. And I still see on the news, news clippings where we interview, you know, very, very narrow-minded, well, bigots, really. And, you know, they will be asked about their solution to the minorities that they don't like, whether it be homosexuals or whatever. And the solution will be something as extreme as they need to basically take all... I don't know why it would be Southern. I'm insulting Spencer without even knowing it, but, you know, you ask them, so what do you do with all the homosexuals? Well, you just need to take them and put them on an island where they can just be by themselves and wallow in their own corruption. Just take them away from us and just dump them somewhere where we never have to interact with them. That's their solution. I've heard this in the real world. That's Genosha. That's exactly what the plan is. Just dump all the mutants on an island away from us with its own rules, its own laws, its own governments, and a lot of giant friggin' robots to keep the worlds up. That's what you do. I'm in for that. That could be movie two.
Is not hinging upon the world ending.
There you go.
Which is the kind of X-Men story I want to see on the big screen.
And to be honest with you, you'll have to remind me, Spencer, but I don't remember at any point that the Dark Phoenix saga was specifically about our world ending. It was just about the powers that Jean had, that she destroyed a world, an alien world, that she was out of control. And it was really just, when it really came down to the last issue, it was just about the stakes for this family to lose a friend over something that they felt was not her fault, and hey, we look after our own. So...
Yeah, it was one of those, granted that, you know, I haven't really read up on it in a long time, but it's, at least in the comic books, it was one of those stories, one of those X-Men stories that took place a lot in outer space and dealt a lot with, like, the Shi'ar Empire, who's hasn't shown up in movies. I wonder if they're tied up, like, they don't know who really owns the rights to them. So it's, I think that one was more of a space thing, and it makes sense why they wouldn't be able to do it in the Singer movies, because, like, they haven't even looked up at the sky in the X-Men movies, except for when Magneto moves the stadium.
Exactly. Oh, I think they've got the rights to the show. I just don't think they'll touch it with a 50-foot pole. It just doesn't make sense for the...
I don't know, because I remember... I looked it up recently, because I wasn't positive, because I really liked the character Kazar. And I was like, who owns the rights to Kazar? And I looked up, and there was an article from... almost 5 years ago now that at the time Marvel was going to directors to do smaller budget movies for their for like third tier characters. Doctor Strange, Luke Cage, and Kazar was listed in that article as an example of something Marvel was pitching to directors. Now granted, it's been long enough and Marvel Studios has made so much money that they're not looking at that anymore. Like, I imagine the thing, those products got folded into the Netflix deal, but the fact that they were thinking about Kazar makes me think that Marvel Studios has him, even though, it seems twisted for that one, because Kazar was a character that he was around before Marvel Comics was Marvel Comics. He was around when they were Timely Comics, but he he reappeared in the modern canon of Marvel in an X-Men comic. But I assume since he was around before them that Marvel has him. It's kind of like the original Human Torch thing. Like, Marvel doesn't have Johnny Storm because he's Fantastic Four, but do they have the android Human Torch because he was a Timely Comics character? I don't know. Like, if I ever meet, if I ever get the opportunity to interview Kevin Feige one-on-one, these are things I want to ask.
I feel so... I honestly do... It sounds ridiculous for me to say I feel sorry for the guy with the best job in the world, but I do feel in some ways sorry for Kevin Feige, because I've noticed... I love watching interviews with him. I love hearing him talk. I never feel that he's faking his passion. I really do feel like he is having a ball, because he is. But, you know, he's brought out a new movie. He's obviously there to promote that movie. And all the questions are about the 20 movies that they haven't announced yet. You know?
I think he knows that going in, too.
Sure.
We're going to ask it, yeah.
It'd just be nice if we knew it, too. That's all. But speaking of which, that is a good segue, actually. Because, speaking of rights issues, there's one particular rights issue with a Marvel Comics character which has been frustrating me for a while. I've mentioned it in shows before. But Namor, the Submariner. I assumed it was a character for the longest time that Marvel had the rights to. I didn't think they'd have even sold it. Turns out they had sold the rights to Namor to Universal. As far as we know, the last time anyone asked Kevin Feige about that issue, he said Universal still has it. And they're doing nothing with it. Now, I understand, you know, they've got other things they want to do. But still, Marvel's in. Marvel's been in for years. If you had a Marvel character that you had the rights to, that you could slap that logo on, you think you'd be at least developing it. And there were very, very minor tremblings a couple of years back, I think, that they were, or a year or so ago. But it amounted to nothing. They're doing nothing with it.
I think it's kind of complicated, because I'm not certain about this. This is me speculating, but I think it's more tied up with a producer than it is tied up with Universal. I think a specific producer, I don't know who it is, has the rights, and they set something up at Universal, and that's why people think it's at Universal. But I think the rights are sort of shared between Marvel and whoever this mystery producer person or production company happens to be, who then set up this rights thing at Universal. I think that's what makes it a little more complicated. But at the same time, Marvel got fucking Spider-Man back. If they wanted Neymar, they'd have him.
That makes sense too. That is true. Which brings us on to the other point, which is that, and this is part of the reason why I want to see him get made. I fully admit, even though I love living in Marvel Land right now, it is getting very, very hard to surprise us visually. All these movies that come out, with few exceptions, we have an inkling. We have a basic idea of what they're going to look like. I'm dying to see Doctor Strange because I have no idea how they're going to visualize the astral planes and all the kind of interdimensional stuff that thing's going to get into, which they've said that's part of the reason why we're making it. We're going to hopefully give visuals that you've never seen before. So that's really, really exciting. But a lot of the other movies, I've got a basic idea what they're going to look like. Even something like Captain Marvel, I've got a basic idea. It's going to look like Guardians. It is. Let's just deal with that. But Submariner, you're dealing with something here which, to this day, this is the kind of thing when we talk about the filmmaking technology that's going to be required to pull it off. This is the kind of thing James Cameron would balk at. We can't do this. Nobody can do this. We are talking about the underwater world. Atlanteans here. We're talking about characters that live and breathe underwater. We're talking about a movie, I would presume, much like 4, would take place at least 50% on the character's home turf. Then maybe later he'll come after the surface dwellers. Who knows? But they do not live underwater in a bubble city that keeps the water out, you know, like Naboo. They live and breathe under the water. So you say to yourself, how in the name of God do you pull that off? That's never been done before, anywhere. And I don't know the answer to that, of course, but the point is, if you could pull it off, you are going to be delivering something that has never been seen before. That right there is a good enough reason. Apart from the fact that, you know, this is a story about a hero who's royalty. He's a fucking prince. Maybe he could be a king in this movie. I'm not quite sure how you want to play it, but, you know, I know Thor's royalty, but it's never really been that big a deal in these movies. You kind of forget it after a while because you spend so much time drinking in bars with Stellan Skarsgård and all that kind of stuff. You don't really think about, you know, the royalty aspect of it and his responsibilities, because he never actually takes them on. He always shakes them off. But Namor doesn't. Namor sits on his throne, and Namor also flies out or swims out and gets shit done from the usurpers like Atuma, who are that's his name, Atuma. it's not Atuma at all, who are trying to take over his kingdom.
to pull the curtain back a little bit, this was a topic we were going to talk about the last time, but we got so involved in Daredevil that we had to bump it to this week. So I've had these notes for the Namor discussion for like two and a half, 3 weeks. And at the bottom of the notes, in all caps and underlined, I wrote, New Thor. It's after Thor Ragnarok, they need to get Namor back. Because he's their new Thor. He's the new fish out of water. He's the new royalty. He's their new branch of fantasy storytelling. Great. Hand to God, I wrote that before you even said it.
Of course. I would like to point out, folks, none of the things I say are my own thoughts. I steal them from everybody. Kevin Feige, Abby Arad, Spencer, you name it. Jamie. I'll steal it from anybody. I don't have an original thought in my head. It's true. Well, what are your other notes? I'm so sorry, Spencer. I want to hear this. What are you going to say?
Well, the two things that I thought could be interesting about the character in including him in the Marvel Cinematic Universe, which is that, okay, they're bringing in Black Panther in Phase 3. He'll be in Civil War. He'll have his own movie. Presumably, he'll be in Infinity War. But and it's really only recently that it's kind of happened that the two have butted heads. But like the idea of Namor versus Black Panther on the big screen, like. What about that doesn't get you excited? Like, the Kingdom of Wakanda versus Atlantis? Like, that's awesome. That's it. That's the pitch. Nothing. You don't have to say anything else.
I like that. I like that.
And the other note that I wrote is, and this is something that I haven't read it myself, but I'm familiar with it from, you know, researching Namor and things like that. But, John Byrne, the writer John Byrne, had a run on Namor where the crux of it was Namor spent all his time on the surface world and became like a legit businessman, which sounds ridiculous when you say it out loud, but it could be kind of cool. Like,
he attorney at law?
I don't think so. He owned he used I think, not positive, so someone can correct us in the comments, but I think he used the wealth of Atlantis to, you know, use that as capital to. I don't think they were an investment firm, but I assume it was something like that. I don't know. That can be brought into the Marvel Cinematic Universe very easily because who else owns a giant company in the Marvel Cinematic Universe?
Apart from Tony, you mean?
Tony Stark. That's it.
Oh, I see.
You position Tony against Namor, not as superheroes, but as businessmen.
Right.
And just... granted, that sounds kind of boring because you're like not setting up like how do you do action in that? You can do action in that. Come on. That's just the base storyline of Namor versus Tony Stark. And granted, I'm pitching stories that aren't hinged upon Namor himself as a singular entity, but that's not how Marvel makes movies anymore.
There'd be a billion creative ways where we could see his apathy for us. I mean, I don't even think about it. My knowledge of Namor is somewhat limited, and I've always seen him. A lot of what I've read has always been the antagonistic Namor who, you know, came after us, the surface dwellers. That's what I love saying that. I've said it like 20 bloody times during this discussion, but I love it. But, I mean, that's the angle I'd be going into it. Maybe you see him differently, I don't know. Has he always hated us, or has he gotten to, you know, make peace with us?
I'm not well-versed in Namor either, but he's never had a happy moment, as far as I can recall. He's always been a bit of a... he's got problems with us.
I mean, that's the end for me. It's just that, you know, it's a story. He's a hero, but he wants to kill us. Wants to kill us all. We spend the first 30 minutes with him. He's a hero. We love him. He's fully established. All that kind of stuff. And then he comes to the surface world. He wants to take us all out, you know. But and our minds are fucked. And, you know, the fingers are pointed at us. And obviously by the end he comes back because a tumor is trying to take over the kingdom and all that stuff. And there is a screenplay out there on the web for it. I know there is. David Self wrote one many years ago. And I don't know who the project was with at that point. But they definitely were trying to get it made at one point. Enough to commission a script. I think it was in the early aughts when all these projects were a go. Yeah, because obviously, yes, I believe Universal bought the rights to Hulk and Namor at the same time.
What a combo.
Hey, you know what? I mean, they had the right idea in a lot of ways. I think they were just like, you know what? Let's just find the best filmmakers, you know? We were all on board for Ang Lee initially, you know? And I still... You know what? My position on those kind of movies is, as and always has been, cinema is richer for having them. Because you can look at a movie like that and say, nobody else would have made it. Nobody else would have made that
movie.
You know
what, though? Namor and Hulk were both on The Defenders.
Mm-hmm.
So maybe that was their thinking. I don't know why they wouldn't get Doctor Strange, too, then. Then they could have been ahead of the game and had their own Avengers-style cinematic universe then, but granted, nobody was that smart back then.
Hey ho. But that's it for this week, folks. We've kept it pretty tight. Next time, as you probably I probably already told you anyway, won't be a marveling at the future next week, because next week's all about the box office predictions. But obviously there will be a little bit of comic book magic in those, with the Avengers and Fantastic Four and fucking... Is there an Entourage movie coming out? No, what's this?
There is.
No, that's right, yes.
Is it this summer?
Yes. No, Spencer. This summer. Say it right.
But you know what that means, though, since the next one is the box office show and there's no Marveling at the Future, which is that the next show we will have seen Marvel's Daredevil.
Some of us earlier than others, yes, but we will have us.
Looking at the calendar, you know, we record it every other week, so you guys are going to record, I assume, the weekend of the 3rd or the 4th.
That's
box
right.
Show.
And so then 2 weeks later, we'll be back.
Friday the 17th will be the next time you and I get together. So that's a week after Daredevil. So
we haven't even discussed this privately, folks, but I think what we're going to do, if the way I see it in my head, if the show's as good as I'm expecting to, we're easily going to be able to fill 2 hours just talking about it. So I'm pretty sure that the show after the box office special will probably just be a 2-hour Daredevil special. We can't do audio commentaries on all of the shows. This would be friggin' ridiculous. Or do a review for every single one, for every episode of Movie Moan as we go forward. That's going to take forever. Season fucking 2 will be out by the time of... Hey, that's not a bad plan. I'll make the time go faster. No. We'll just do it as a special, and I think we'll just gush. That's the plan. And that is all it is. We have not seen it yet, but certainly things are looking very, very good. I'll see you there, Spencer.
Oh, I will be there with bells on.
All right, folks.
Daredevil will know I'm coming.
Even Okay, folks. Well, we'll see you on the next Marveling at the Daredevil. Marveling at the... You know what I mean. It's the Daredevil show. Hey, I wasn't lying. So I guess with that little James Horner rant we were having a little bit before, that's it's a nice little segue into something that I've been teasing for a while. It's the return of cinematic campy comfort food. This week we're joined by a wonderful new special guest star, a lady called Hannah, who I met on Twitter and just wanted to get her on the show. I just loved her opinions, and she told me what her top 3 favorite movies were, and one of them was the movie we're going to discuss tonight, which of course is James Cameron's Aliens, which I could discuss right now or tomorrow or the day after that. I could discuss it any time. So it's great to finally get round to this one. So watch as I put Hannah in charge and we discuss James Cameron's Aliens.
What's that about?
ITV and Diet Coke presents Movie Premiere.
Wonderful. He, I don't know, he's very curious.
What's up, Jay? Okay, everybody, when you're ready, we'll have the camera in first position.
Hello, everybody, and welcome to another edition of Cinematic Happy Comfort Food. And you knew this one was coming. I mean, there's a clip of it on our little intro sequence, so I think that was a tease right there. Who the heck knows? Maybe it would have subconsciously inspired someone to pick this movie. But I'm very, very delighted that it has been chosen, because it is, no word of a lie, my second favourite movie ever. Here to talk about it tonight is a very special guest, new to the show. Someone I have been, I guess, pounding is the correct terminology, on Twitter, to join us today. Do so. Will you please welcome Hannah Southwell? Hannah, what is the movie that you've chosen for us?
Hello, the film I've chosen is Aliens, plural, the second one, directed by the wonderful James Cameron.
Fantastic. Now, Hannah, I mean, it seems so self-evident why we would pick Aliens, but I don't want to take that miracle of a movie for granted. So, personally, what does the movie mean to you? Why is it the movie that you would pull off the shelf at any time and it would hit the sweet spot for you?
I think it's because, I mean, on the surface of it, it's such a fun film. It's so much fun. And it's so clever and action-orientated. It's so tense. Even if you've been seeing it many, many times like I have, I'll still get stuck in watching it, especially the end sequences. But it also kind of holds a lot of nostalgia value for me as well. I mean, I've loved this film since I was about 14. And just it's grown from there. And the older I've got, the more I've got out of it. It's one of those kind of films where you watch it on a surface level, when you're a kid and think, oh my god, that's fantastic. Like, my dad was always very trusting of me and my sister when we were kids, and you know, he let us go and see Terminator 2 when we were 12 and it was a 15, and I tried 5 times to see it and then I got in twice, and so I think he knew we were prepared to watch a film like that. And actually, if you think about it now, it's been re-rated to a 15. It's not that violent, so seeing it at 14 is not so much of a big deal. But I remember seeing it when I was 14, and Dad said, you've got to watch this film, it's amazing. Watch it with me. I think it was on ITV or something. We watched it, and it was just like, wow, that's amazing. And then since then, I got older and knew who Bill Paxton was and thought he was a great actor. Michael Biehn, Sigourney Weaver, Lance Henriksen. And the more you study it and the more you understand it, the better it becomes.
I had a pretty similar experience, actually, and it is one of those memories of my childhood that I've never forgotten. It was, I don't know if it was the premiere, but definitely when it was shown, like, if it wasn't the first time, it was definitely the second time that it was shown on ITV, and my mum taped it off the telly, and then let me watch it the morning after, because, of course, in those days of yore, you had to go to bed early. So I went to bed at 9, didn't get to watch it. Got to watch it in the morning, and I was absolutely fine with it. Watching Aliens in the broad daylight, it's a slightly different experience. I wouldn't recommend it, but I was fine until The Queen.
Oh, really?
Oh, yes, The Queen, because, and it's still an effect which stuns me to this day. That thing is not a puppet to me. That thing is real. As soon as it shows up and its head retracts from the crown and it's dripping with ooze and acid, and it roars, and it's unbelievably huge. That thing is real to me, and it freaked me out. And what I remember most is that my little brother, who's 6 years younger than me, I was freaked out and he was just transfixed, and then would occasionally turn back to me and say, what's the big deal, this is totally wicked. And but no, it completely freaked me out. And I think what I always love about it is that, you know, that's just the cherry. I mean, the movie would be a perfectly epic 2 hours without that climax. But Absolutely. That really is just the cherry on top of the unrelenting tension we've experienced for the last 2 hours. And that's the other thing that I always like to remind people of, is that I remember when it first came out, some critics didn't like it. Like, we always go back on our show to Siskel and Ebert, and I can't remember if they gave it a thumbs up or a thumbs down, but I do remember specifically what Ebert said was that...
He's on the one hand, it's very well made. Sigourney Weaver does a terrific, very strong acting job. She holds the movie together with a powerful performance. The special effects are outstanding. The movie is scary and horrifying and disgusting from one end to the other, and I have nothing but admiration for its craftsmanship. But on the other hand, and this is a big but, at the end of the movie, you know what? I felt really bad. My stomach was all knotted up, and I was jumpy and unhappy and tense, and it took me a while to get back to normal again. Aliens was so strong, it was overkill. It really did upset me.
That's actually fascinating. I don't know if you've read that piece. Was it Matt Zoller Seitz wrote recently about he showed it to a group of 11-year-old boys. Mm. And you read that?
Yeah, I did.
Yeah, that was just interesting. And again, I think he took a bit of flack for showing it to 11-year-old boys, and he said that the parents were aware and they trusted him to give his judgment on what the boys could see. But their reactions to it, again, for a dated film, dated in inverted commas, for boys to see it and they still absorbed in it and were not scared by it, apart from maybe one of them, I find it really interesting that a film that's supposedly old can do so well. But I can see why reviewers at the time were taken aback maybe by it, because you think about how the first one was so artistic, aesthetically, story-wise, and then you do a quiet, haunted house in space story, and then you come around and you do the action, Vietnam analogy or whatever, you want to apply to it, to have a very different take on that same story. I can see why maybe some reviewers who weren't aware what they're going in for were surprised by it, but I think it's always interesting to see how many people count Aliens as their favourite of a series, and I think quite a few do, don't they, really? And you probably agree with me because you like it so much.
I've always distanced myself from that opinion myself. I mean, it is, but it was the first one I saw. And in that very same way, I'm sure there are plenty of people who, were lucky enough to, be at the perfect age when Alien debuted. And that would be their favourite in the series, most likely, not just because of the masterpiece that it is, but also the impact that it had on them at the time. And then going into a film like this, which is so, even for the time, so different, and you wonder just whether they were even ready for it, because it was not Alien 2. This was truly Aliens. Yeah. So I wonder a lot about that. But certainly for me, and if you grow up in the 80s, and you grow up with the climate of 80s action movies, which were the comic books of the time, there is Aliens is what Aliens is about. They even brought out the toys afterwards, and I had all the toys, and I had the power loader, and it was great, and the arcade game, and there's so much that you can't detach yourself from. I also think that to this day, and this is one of the reasons why I can always watch it, it is the most perfectly lightning-paced film I have ever seen in my life. Now, I always go for the special edition, folks, which is, I think, 156 minutes. I'm being a little anal retentive about this, but I'm pretty sure that's as long as it is. And it always stuns me how I'm watching the film, and the aliens don't show up for the first attack until minute 70, I think, of the movie. But every time I see the movie, the aliens show up, I basically look at the counter on my DVD player and I go, we're at 70 minutes. Where the hell did that 70 minutes go?
Absolutely. You think about that's almost the running length of some movies, and, stuff is happening. But I think it's one of those things that he's very clever at, James Cameron. He's kind of slowly sort of, talking up the tension a bit. And you've got these marine guys which are fascinating, got some blowhards in there,
Hudson, come here! Come here!
Exactly. So you've got these guys who are, all mouth, and you're thinking, what's going to happen to these guys when they actually meet? You're getting to know them to a certain degree, and then when things, kick off, then you realise whether you care about them or not, and I think that's key. Even though we don't get to see much of Drake, we know what he meant to Vasquez when he dies. It's that kind of thing. You still feel for him, like, you know, he's her best friend. So little things like that, he's very, very good at building up. You know, there's a lot of characters in that sequence, and then actually making you care about the key ones before everything then kicks off. And then once they get into the, you know, the real crux of the battle with the alien for the first time, then, it, like you say, it just speeds off from there and doesn't really let up.
And that's even more impressive when you think about the fact that there are 3 action sequences in the film. This is not, it's not a, I don't think of it as an action movie. It's a siege picture. You know, you have the battle at that 70-minute mark, and then up until the two-hour mark when they finally, you know, manage to burst down the doors again of this little, tiny little stronghold which they've been holed up in with nothing but those 4 malfunctioning turret guns to protect them. And for that huge gap of time... Oh, no, of course, there's the facehugger attack, I suppose, with where they fight Ripley and Newt in the med lab. I forgot about that bit. Okay, there's 4 sequences.
Yeah, I mean, that's kind of like a little aside, isn't it? It's kind of maybe action, but not quite as big. It's kind of contained, isn't it? But still a great sequence.
You don't even think about, when you think about the imagery of that, I mean, how absurd it sounds in concept that these tiny little, you know, facehugger things are a huge threat. These Marines, they've got pulse rifles. I mean, Hicks actually blows away the facehuggers with the pulse rifle. They're all big and buff. What's the problem? These things, they move. They're puppets. They move.
Yeah, it's kind of like, well, they look like spiders, obviously, but it's kind of like the idea of spiders being scared of something that's so small. But actually can really hurt you. I mean, it's interesting because you can't really fight him. And when that in that sequence, when Ripley's being attacked by him and trapped in the room, obviously she's trying to fight it. But really, with if they didn't come, you couldn't fight them. Even though they're small, they would still get you in the end. So, I mean, again, it's all in the clever design, isn't it? The fact that these things can strangle you at the same time. It's a tiny little thing. It looks gross, like a spider. It's, yeah, I mean, but all the design of that kind of helps with the tension of those scenes, I think. But again, it's interesting that you say you come back to the turret guns, because obviously that sequence is all very key to the special edition. And it's one of the things I'm always really interested about. Well, I know they were cut for time, but those turret guns really, again, are another small addition to help the tension when you watch them just go down in bullets. And then, you know, they're wall to wall in there. It's kind of the idea that there's so many of these things. That really helped demonstrate that this tiny group of people are against a huge army that are unrelenting and not going to give up.
That you never see.
No, exactly. And I think it's a big shame. Obviously, most people nowadays can see the special edition. When we were kids, you know, seeing the special edition was difficult. I mean, you had to wait for the VHS to come out. But nowadays, you know, the special edition is on Sky Movies. But back then, it was like this mystical thing of seeing these turret guns sequences. What that? And you see it, and oh my god, why did they ever cut that out? I think James Cameron is one of the directors whose special editions are some of the best, and it always baffled me why, you know, well, I suppose nowadays maybe it wouldn't be cut, but back then people wanted tighter films. But it always strikes me he's a director who suffered, his films have not suffered, but have been, he could have done more had he not been cut out by The Abyss. The same thing happened with The Abyss, kind of the film that he wanted to make was not the film he ended up with, and the same thing with Aliens to a degree. And I mean, talking of cut scenes in Aliens, losing a reference to Ripley's daughter is kind of very key to that entire film and her relationship with Newt.
I agree, but I do feel that, I mean, I did manage for, with the exception of The Abyss, that is the one exception to what I'm talking about, but for years and years, we all managed to survive and accept these films as they were. I mean, I was, he never did a special edition of the Terminator, but yeah. I remember when I first saw those deleted scenes, there's this wonderful scene where Michael Biehn has a complete breakdown psychologically because he's in the real world that hasn't been blown to shit, and it's beautiful, and he just completely breaks down on the side of the road. It hurts, Sarah. It's so beautiful. And I'm like, man, this is a great scene. I want to see this in the movie. And he doesn't include it, but it doesn't need it. It doesn't need it. I mean, I feel like Cameron's actually one of those few directors who... He's been accused of being, you know, making movies that are bloated and fat, and I don't think that's fair. I mean, I really think he's actually one of the few directors that knows how to cut your darlings, cut those scenes that you personally love, that mean a lot to you, but the movie doesn't need them.
No, No, they're almost like they're like just additional gold. As I said, none of the cuts he makes, apart from, apart from this, like you said, I think that the end of this doesn't make sense without the special edition additions. But even the Terminator 2, the special edition, and seeing what happened to Sarah during the nuclear blast, and seeing Reese come back and see her in her dream, kind of, those are nice additions. But James Cameron, again, I think he gets a lot of flack, especially since Titanic and Avatar, but it's very easy to be negative of his work. But actually, if you think about what he's done, you know, a lot of very, very good films. And I don't think people disagree his films are good, but I think that people forget about his craft. He doesn't really seem to be appreciated in terms of his craft a lot, in terms of how very good he is about writing characters or great stories as well. As I said earlier, one of the things I found with his work, especially with Aliens growing older, is that being aware that Ripley's a woman and she's doing these things as a lead character. And when you're a kid, that's great, and you don't necessarily see the divide between male and female. But the older you get, the more I've realised how James Cameron is very, very good at creating female characters that are not just the stereotypical tough woman in terms of them being muscular tough, but having a great mix of femininity and maternalism, and just being strong-minded. And that's something that he has in Terminator and The Abyss especially, and with what he did with Ripley. I mean, she was already tough in the first film, but she was tough by accident. She had to survive. Whereas in Aliens, she says, I don't want to go back. And then she goes, no, I have to go back. And she does. And she goes back to the planet, and then she could leave, but she goes back for new. And I love that sequence of her in the lift when she's going back down. And you can tell that she's scared and that she is trying to breathe through it, and just the determination that she's going to go and get Newt. I think it's so fantastic. It's just a very small sequence, a very small performance by Sigourney, but just what that stands for in terms of just being a fantastic female character, of being feminine, maternal, but also tough. And she's going back and she's going to get this thing. She's going to face off against the Queen, and she's going to show them who's boss, basically. And she does that with that fantastic head tilt that she does, like, come on. And then she goes off on them. So, that whole sequence was brilliant. I'm
so glad you mentioned it. It's my favourite scene. I think that scene alone got her the Oscar nomination. I really do. That's an incredible scene, that elevator scene. Especially with it's the music as well. That they just do unrelenting tension at that point. Yeah. I also found it interesting how these days, and maybe it's just because it's the cool thing to do, or we're so immature, or we're so bloody cynical, but when did we reach the point that we immediately roll our eyes when we hear about putting children in these kind of movies, children in action movies, when we can always say that one of the greatest action movies of all time, if you want to call it that, has a kid in it, and she's one of the best things in the movie. I remember our partner on the show, Jamie, his favourite moment in the entire movie is when Hudson goes, why did you put her in charge? You know. And Carrie Henn just brilliantly downplays everything. She'll just do a little thumbs up or a little salute, or play with a grenade just in a little quick cutaway. Don't play with that. It's dangerous. Yeah. You know. All these tiny little things, maybe that's the key to it, that it's just downplayed. It's never cutesy for a single second. I don't think Cameron knows how to do cutesy anyway, so... Yeah, they're dead! Can I go now?
Yeah, just like hard, just gone. But then she comes back out again, which is lovely. And then at the end you get the idea that he had, the mother and father.
She says mummy at the very end. It just breaks you.
Yeah, and then David Fincher came along and spoiled everyone's dreams, whether it's his fault or not. And obviously that's the next tangent of where that story's going to go with this new Alien movie, whether they're going to continue the idea of Newton Hicks and some other different way, or I'm fascinated to see what they're going to do with that, actually.
just make it about the scary monster in the dark. If that game taught us anything, and I completely agree, I mean, the more I played Alien Isolation, the more I realized how completely implausible it would be for Newt to survive. She survived for 40 days. I can't last 5 minutes. This is ridiculous, you know? That game is so hard. But it just tuned into everything we love about the series. Yeah, the production design of it is one thing, and the music and how it conjures up the world that Ridley Scott and his team created. But also just the fact that it's not about the beast and seeing it, and you can make it as good looking as you want. But, you know, I don't need to see it. All I need to see is a little blip on a tracker and that sound effect. Or in that turret gun sequence we've been talking about, you do not see a single creature, I think, in that sequence once. I don't even think you see the turrets actually firing down the corridor for more than one shot or two shots. You literally are just looking at a computer screen as the ammo rounds just count down. You can make it low... I know it sounds ridiculous, you can't make anything low budget these days, but you can make something smart rather than expensive. That's the thing that I respect more than anything. They shot smart with this movie. It cost $18 million, and you get... 3 movies worth of epicness in this movie that you just wouldn't get in. And that's the problem, I suppose, that the series has always had. It's just that you couldn't evolve it after this. You literally couldn't, unless you did Aliens on Earth. And then that would... I know we've all said we want it, but it just won't have the scary monster, GPS tracker and all that kind of stuff.
Exactly. And we kind of already had that with Alien vs. Predator. And that was, you know, didn't really work. Even... You know, Predator 2 is kind of, when you put something like that in a world that is so large and so us, I would find that so bizarre to see aliens on Earth. I think they're going to have to keep it in space somehow. And if, you know, the end of Resurrection was them coming to Earth, if they wrote themselves into a corner, then perhaps sort of retconning or going back a different tangent from the other films is the only way to go to make it realistic. But I'm really interested to see what they're going to be doing. I'm not against it particularly, until obviously we know what's going to happen. But I mean, I'm all for seeing more of Ripley and seeing more of Sigourney Weaver. She loves that character. Then I want to see her, you know, do it. She's not doing it out of obligation. She's not been, you know, contracted to do it and you're going to get some tired old phoned in performance. She loves Ripley and she's going to be, you know, giving all she's got. And I can't imagine that she would be, you know, lying down letting anyone do anything to that character that she doesn't want them to do.
I just keep finding this idea, and I hopefully it's not going to be in this new movie, but the idea that I always hate, that I always feel misses the point, is this idea of, you know, capturing the aliens or weaponizing them or looking at them behind glass and stuff. And, you know, I think that's part of the reason why I just can't watch a Resurrection. It has a lot of that. But it's just like, it's not about that. I don't want to see them. I don't want to know where they are. This is easy. You know, yes. They have to be free. They have to be, they could be anywhere. They could be, you could be sitting on the toilet and the alien could be underneath about to suck you under. I'm happy with any of it. Gosh.
I mean, knowing they can swim was like, oh my God, they can swim too. When you get that in Resurrection, oh my, like you can't even get away from them underwater. They'll come after you as well. But I think, yeah, coming back to Aliens, one of the key things about them being like, you know, they're just there is obviously the sequence when they're trapped in the room and they check in the tracker and they can't work out where they are and they, you know, that can't be, that's in the room. And then you get that fantastic shot of Hicks, you know, Michael Biehn with a brilliant face, just bringing that rifle up and looking in the ceiling, turning, and almost all of a sudden they're there, just crawling along. And again, the effect of that is genius because it's dark. There's probably, you know, 3 guys in a suit crawling along the ceiling and that's all you need to know. And it's such a fantastic sequence. That whole bit of them just being, you know, caught out by something they thought was clever. They've got all the weapons, all the training, and yet here they come in the ceiling vent. Brilliant. I just love that bit.
That's incredible because, I mean, that's an example of Cameron actually giving the audience the illusion that they're a step ahead. They're literally a frame ahead of the movie, because when they actually realise what's happened and how they're inside the room because they're in the ceiling, there's that quick pause which allows the audience to go and slap their head and realise what's actually happened before the characters actually realise it. That's the best thing about it. Pop quiz for you, Hannah. This is going to prove whether just how much of a fan you are. Can you name every one of the Marines?
Well, I could do the main Marines. Obviously, you've got Hicks, Hudson, Vasquez, Drake, Gorman, Apone, Spunkmeyer, Dietrich. There's Dietrich Frost off the board. No, I can't get the rest there. Oh, what's her name? The 5x5.
No, that's Spunkmeyer.
Yeah, Pharaoh.
Oh, Sparrow.
Yeah, the rest, I'm trying to think of visualize them off the screens, and no, I can't get them all. But
it's okay. You had them most. I mean, I think you missed Frost. I think you missed Frost. I'm not quite sure. And Wabowski?
Oh yeah, he says that in the first siege, you're trying to hear everyone's name. But yeah, that's again because they're all, there's quite a few of them, but not so many that you can't see all their faces. But they don't always get name checked. But yeah, I mean, that sequence again, it's been often imitated, you think about how other sequences do that, the video camera on their helmets, so they can see each other shouting at each other, and you get the names at the bottom, and the heart rates, and the cameras are flashing off, I think that's been imitated a lot, and that sequence is, again, is very clever for getting a lot out of a very basic shot. You're building up tension by just not seeing anything and just hearing a lot of people shouting and going, oh my god, what's going on? Brilliant.
The one bit I've never been able to figure out, though, and maybe you can help me, is that there are, whether it's in the context of a kind of a space action movie kind of thing, or whether it's something more with a horror angle, like, friggin' Event Horizon or something, that just came off the top of my head, but there's so many examples where you have a crew of ragtag characters on a spaceship and you have, a very short amount of time to get to know them and get to care about them, if assuming that you do at all. And what I find so unbelievable about Aliens is that, first of all, there's about friggin' 20 of them, and you remember most of them, but also that they are introduced in a very, antagonistic, confrontational, slightly seedy way, all these characters, and that you love them all. I mean, if you go through it, it's like, it starts with, they're all waking up, and, let's face it, Drake doesn't look like the handsomest man, as he snarls, I ain't getting paid enough for this, and then they start talking about, picking up Arterian Poontang, yeah. And making fun of that kind of thing while...
that kind of thing. And
that's
then
right.
Hudson being, again, the blowhard, he can do whatever he likes, and then Bishop does the, Bishop, hey, man. The whole thing with a knife, you're getting the measure of this man already by being, oh, yeah, 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 and then actually, gets the crap scared out of him I prefer the term artificial person myself, by a droid, basically. But we should talk about Bishop, really, in terms of how it sets him up that, Ripley doesn't like him because of what happened with Ash. She didn't want any droids on board. And how Lance Henriksen is, he's a brilliant actor anyway, but how he plays that quite nuanced and really sympathetic, and how he, wins you over by being the guy that, makes a sacrifice to go along the tunnel and go out and get the ship, and how he manages to sort of, initially he has that face where he can be creepy, but then you soon realise that actually he's a good guy, and I think it's really clever.
Eyes are massive.
Yes.
They don't seem human to me.
No, exactly, no, they don't. I mean, and if you get along right to the end, they're not bad for a human, and he called his autobiography that title. And obviously, it meant a lot for him to do that role. And one other thing I wanted to say about Aliens in particular is that one of the things, again, that James Cameron does with female characters is that whilst he might have a romance aspect in some of them, it doesn't... I mean, I'd like to think nowadays how this film would play out, and I hope it would be medium different, but Ripley is not asexual, but... her relationship with Hicks is friendship with the hint of something else, maybe. But I always like that sequence between them when, he's showing her how to use the gun, and, says, if it comes to that, I'll do us both, in terms of they have a sort of mutual respect. She's a woman, he's a man, and maybe things would happen further down the line, because there's that sequence in the special edition when they give each other's names. Like, he says he's Dwayne, and she says she's Ellen, which is lovely. But, it doesn't have to be any romance. There's no, I'll come and save you because I'm the guy. It's kind of, you're the damsel in distress, you're the woman. It's kind of, he just plays them as, these are just people who are getting on with each other. And that's one of the things I've always liked about what James Cameron does with female characters. Same thing with Sarah Connor, and even Lindsay Bergman in Abyss to a degree, is that they're just kind of people who can do stuff like any other one else can. And that mutual respect of each character, male or female, I think is brilliant. And again, it's interesting, as you come back to those boys we were talking about before, about the slumber party, this story, that their favourite character was Vasquez, which I think was brilliant. In kind of, you know, you have Hicks, a great character. Hudson is a great character, even though he's a bit, you know, a coward to begin with. He's saying, you know, he fights his way out in the end. But Vasquez is the one they loved. And obviously she's the butch woman, you know, the tough woman character. But the fact they love her, I think that's really, you know, impressive in terms of, it doesn't matter that she's a woman. It just, she's just this brilliant character. And that is something, as I keep saying, that James Cameron just excels at in terms of seeing beyond the gender and just writing a good character.
Nothing's overplayed with her. Like, in any other movie, she'd be trying to, there'd be at least five scenes of her trying to kill Gorman, trying to break down the doors to get to him and stuff. And it's something they mention once, and then Hicks says, back off, and she follows orders, and it's, the tension's always there, but she's focused on the mission. With Hicks, it's the thing that I always took away from Hicks, apart from the fact that he's, you know, they just don't make guys like Michael Biehn anymore. Action men aren't just built the same way. But he was the most amazing example of the lethality of the aliens, because I remember how he, you know, he's a survivor. He's made it the entire way through the picture, and then at the last minute, before the full climax, he gets taken out of it because he shoots one of the aliens and they explode, and he gets a little bit of acid on him. It's only a little bit, but the next time we see him, it's like half his body. He's basically been two-faced. Half his body is not non-functioning.
It's spray, but obviously, I mean, you think it's on his chest plate, and it's burning through his chest plate. So potentially, it's going into his lungs. Do you think that is what's taking him out? I've always thought that. So, like, well, how much acid did he get on him, really? But I think it's if you look at it, that it's got into his chest. But you're right, with a splash on his face. And it's interesting, again, with these Neil Blomkamp concept images. He'd done the whole burn face thing, so it's interesting. I'd never really grasped that that was when it happened to Hicks, that he was going to have that face disfigurement. But I mean, we should perhaps talk about Burke as well, in terms of Ripley's relationship with him.
He's really an okay guy.
Yeah. But again, it's kind of the slimy company. The underlying story that these have is that, you know, there's always these guys that are trying to weaponize the aliens. And that's why I'm saying that you're right, that we've done this now, right up to Alien 3, with other company, that you know, the supposed bishop comes back and tries to, you know, encourage Ripley to keep herself alive. Is that they? How much can you keep playing that storyline of wanting to study these aliens? Can you not just leave that part alone now? If you're going to go on a new tangent, we've done that now.
I've always found it the least interesting part of these movies. Not to take anything away from Burke. In fact, I only just noticed now, just mentioning it out loud, but that scene where he says he's an okay guy, that's a dream. It's not real. So that's a clue right there that he's up to no good.
Again, the thing is, you have a great actor like Paul Reiser anyway, and makes him slimy, and just makes him... It's that scene when it's like, you know, I say we grease this rat fuck son of a bit, just kind of like he's sweating, and he's so slimy, and just, you know, he's brilliant in that scene. Of just, like, I'm just doing my job, guy, but actually, you know, he put people at risk to do what he's supposed to be doing for the company, and you wonder, how much is this guy getting paid to do this job? But yeah, I think if you move away from the company is always going to be there, but the underlying idea of them is always going to be, you know, an interesting concept of who are these people that are putting other humans at risk and for what purpose. But maybe the next one should sort of stay away from that. And you're right, just keep it simple and keep it with the aliens. I'm just fascinated to see what they'll actually do in terms of placement. Where are they going to be? What's the next place you can put aliens in that's going to be scary?
I mean, I get the impulse, because I think all it is in the later films is that they took a line from Aliens and ran with it, the line being, I don't know which species is worse. You don't see them fucking each other over for a goddamn percentage. So they just took that line and they ran with it. And obviously, you know, in a movie like Prometheus, it's, you know, we are the aliens because we're alien to that planet and all that kind of stuff. But I don't think they need to take it any longer. And incidentally, I wish I still had a copy of it. No, I don't think anyone owns, still has their videos. Certainly not the videos they taped off the telly. But I wish I had mine for Aliens, because I swear the version that we taped off the telly, the line, I say we grease this rat fuck son of a bitch, I swear it's something else. Like, I say we get rid of this guy right now. I swear it's something else.
It's funny you say that, because both my sister and I, we can recall a lot of those lines, like where the ad breaks were and what the Melon Farm lines were. It's actually, it's rat fat son of a bitch.
Ah, right, thank you.
And it's funny, you know, the friggin' A instead of fucking A. It's kind of, you can hear all of these Melon Farmwood lines in my head still, because we would watch it literally on repeat. I mean, again, coming back to what this movie means to me, I mean, I just watch it, like, every day, you know, consistently. I mean, any chance I could, I'd be watching that. If I went away, you know, I remember once going away to be looked after by my uncle and aunt, and we brought Aliens. And we'd watch it. I said, do you want to watch Aliens? Like, let's watch Aliens. Like, let's just watch it over and over again. Just, you know, that one copy on from ITV with the ad breaks in it. But it's just, yeah, I mean, you wish you kept it, don't you? You wish you keep these sort of nostalgic value things that just don't exist anymore.
I suppose in those days, they used to break for news at 10, so, you know, it did feel a lot longer than it actually was, especially with the commercials and stuff.
The good old days, the good old days.
I'm not sure I'd go that far. I mean,
I'm being very, very sarcastic.
Oh, excuse me, of course. Yeah, I'll tell you one experience I had with Aliens that I will... I'll never trade this for the world. It wasn't the most pleasant experience of my life, but it was certainly unique. I finally did get the opportunity to see it on the big screen. It was this promotional event for an alcohol company, which I shall not name. But they used to do these themed movie nights, and they had this gig for Aliens in Manchester, which I went to, having no expectation of what I was going to get myself in for, except the fact that I was going to finally get to see Aliens on the big screen. And what we ended up with is seeing Aliens on Laserdisc, projected onto a brick wall in a freezing cold warehouse. And I got to tell you, which they decorated, like they put a few little guys dressed in costumes, and the alien was there in a costume and hanging around in the background and stuff and trying to scare people. But I tell you, it was a weird experience that kind of helped. You know, Aliens doesn't need that kind of artificiality to make it stronger. But seeing it in the freezing cold in a warehouse, that was pretty cool too.
But yeah, I mean, it wasn't so extreme like secret cinema, but just enough to have the impact. But did you feel like you were really watching it properly, or would you still rather want to go and see it like in a proper cinema?
Just to experience the, if nothing else, honestly, it's just to experience the comedy of it with a crowd. The movie's hysterically funny to me, but it's not just because of the jokes. It's actually, like all my favourite movies, it's transcended that now. It's more just about the line delivery and the fact that I just remember it so much. It's just like, you know, what is so funny about the line assholes and elbows? I don't know. It just is funny because Al Matthews is just genuinely funny. All right, you heard the man and you know the drill. Assholes and elbows. I said, come here. You know, and it has to be said that way. Or not at all. You have to say it exactly that way.
Yeah, I love the fact that you can recite them like I can. It's the sign of someone that's watched that film a lot. It's in like your secondary memory warehouse of just being held there, and you need to recall it back when you need it, but it's always there because you've just seen it so many times. But again, it's one of those films that is so quotable. You know, I think a lot of people say Game Over Man and don't always know exactly where that's come from, but it's still in the zeitgeist. And also with the internet memes and things, those things always sort of come back in a cyclical manner, but people remember those Hudson lines. And again, a lot of it is just down to Bill Paxton. I mean, he's a great actor, and obviously his career with James Cameron has been brilliant anyway. But I don't know if I've ever really got to the bottom of how many of his lines have been improv'd or ad-libbed or have been written into the script because they're, you know, Pactonism, because, you know, they stop you grinning and drop your linen. I don't know if that was in the script or whether that was something that Bill Paxton came up with. I know he did the same thing in Weird Science, Apollo 13. A lot of the lines in the movie are things that he came up with.
It's more like the, we got guns, knives, sharp sticks. Hudson, give us a break. It's not that kind of thing. And all the yells, you know, when he's in the dropship and all that kind of stuff.
The dialogue, again, for a film that is not about quotability, is really quotable still. And that, again, is a sign of it being a sort of a benchmark movie. Especially for a lot of people, but in terms of just how it hits a lot of marks for a lot of different people in different ways. But, you know, kids are going to be watching this now, and, you know, you think about it, it's a 30-year-old movie, it's kind of old. It's old. But for kids to watch it and think it's great and funny and quote the lines back, it's kind of one of those films that will keep living on. And it doesn't date. It doesn't feel old, even though it is. It's the picture, it does not feel old. I think he's kind of in the whole aesthetic of it, which is the same thing with Alien. If you said it sort of retro, even though it's modern, it won't really date because it doesn't look like anything stereotypically futuristic. It looks like it could be in any time, so it won't be alienating to any audiences watching it now. I think it's something very clever about that. I think, you know, that was what was clever in Alien as well, the kind of, you know, the truckers in space kind of idea, and the same thing came across in Aliens, and you get a film which kind of lives on.
I want to leave us with one final image from the film, which really cements to me just how good it is, because it's basically bulletproof. There is a scene in this movie which, to me, as soon as I describe it, I think you'll understand, is so ridiculous. In any other movie, it would be endlessly ridiculed, I think, because it is so laughably absurd and funny, and yet in the movie it just works brilliantly because we care about the characters, because these guys can't get a break. Everything happens to them. It's not just about the aliens and the fact that they lose pretty much everybody in the cast, but the fact that you know, the nuclear reactor's gonna blow and everything. It's just like, you better come down here, I got some bad news. Oh, that's a switch! And all that kind of stuff, you know. And there's one bit in the movie which is so absurd, and no one talks about it too, because it doesn't matter. It's the bit where the dropship crashes. They're waiting to be picked up. They're gonna get out of here. The dropship is hijacked by an alien. Not quite sure how it even got there, actually, but it gets there and it kills the pilot, Spunkmeyer, and it crashes and it blows up. And they're all, you know, just in utter despair, just wandering around aimlessly, mute, solid as a rock, standing there in the rocks, desolate landscape, image of the burning dropship behind her. And she says to Ripley, "It's okay, it wasn't your fault." That bit kills me every time. It is so absurd, but it doesn't matter, because that's Aliens, folks. Hannah, thank you so much for choosing it.
Oh, you're welcome. No, thanks very much for having me. I've had a, you know, a good time talking about it. I could talk a lot longer, but I won't.
No, exactly. We could. We will. We will. You guys, get out of here. Go on. Off with you. So, folks, that's it for this week's Movie Moment 2015. So we will join you, and I know you'll be there with bells on for the summer 2015. I was going to say 2016. I can't wait. I want to jump.
That'll be a fun one.
In fact, at this point, I think what might be fun for you guys is I'll let you know what the roster is going to be. As you probably have already guessed, if you're a long-time listener of our box office shows, the lineup special guest star-wise will be myself, Jamie, Mr. Edward Douglas, otherwise known as the Weekend Warrior, on superhero-comingsoon.net. He is their box office expert. And from boxoffice.com, the expert, Mr. Sean Robbins. And we're going to be discussing such movies as, if I bring up my little calendar here, Avengers Age of Ultron, Mad Max Fury Road, Pitch Perfect 2, Tomorrowland, Poltergeist, San Andreas, Jurassic World, Pixar's Inside Out, Ted 2, Terminator Genesis, Minions, Ant-Man, Pan, Pixels, Mission Impossible 5, and The Fantastic Four. That's 16 movies right there. We had to cut Man from U.N.C.L.E., we had to cut Entourage, we had to cut Spy. Can't say I'm too sad about losing that one. I hate your country then. But we're going to talk about those 16 movies and take our turns, and you are going to get to be part of the action too and make your predictions. You can only be assured of several things going in. One, Jamie will always underestimate the Marvel movies. I will always I will massively overpredict on Tomorrowland way more than anyone else, most likely. And none of us will probably even come close on Pan.
I think we're all going to get Pan pretty spot on.
Okay, fair enough. Well, Pixels then. We're going to have a pretty good fight about Pixels, aren't we, Jamie?
Yes, there's us and me. It's so obvious what's going to happen with that movie, but okay.
Oh, enlighten me. Show your hand daily. This is a classic trick in
poker. Hey, I would back you up, Jamie, but I don't get to be there.
Exactly. No, Pixels is going to be huge.
Man, we're starting the fight early, but I hope you can join us in 2 weeks' time for...
So help me God if you think Avengers 2 is going to do $600 million.
You don't know what I'm going to say yet! You don't have a fucking clue!
He's going to say $700 million, Jamie.
Fucking old people's home. Well, we'll see you in 2 weeks, folks. You take care of yourself.
Me and him are Randolph and Mortimer.